You just might be right, Mr. Just might be right, Mr. Just might be right.
Here we go. Well, good evening and a very warm welcome, one and all, to Dr. Rock's radio show here on peoplesinternetradio.com. As has been pointed out in the chat box, we've got a new number coming up. It's a number we haven't tried before, so let's hope it works a lot better than the last one. We kicked off there with Motorhead and Killed by Death, which goes out for Lemmy, of course, who's now hammering on St. Peter's gates, and he was, of course, killed by death in the long run. Coming to us all, followed by Lone Stars, Women Rule the World, which went out for Laurie for another 365 and a bit days of really, really hard work, keeping the whole game on the road. And then Jack Outer World and the Quantum Singularity Corporate Cosmology. Before I bring Freemanjack in for tonight's conversation, I'd just like to mention that one of the founders of Linux, of the Debian Linux system, died, apparently, at the age of 42 on the night of 28th of December 2015. The people that announced his death, and his current employer, basically broke the news in a blog. But the blogs don't say what caused his sudden death, so I guess there'll be a little bit of thinking about that over the week. It just came in as I went live, so I haven't had really time to look at it. There's a fair few people, is my impression, are dying rather mysteriously currently. Possibly a subject for a show all on its own. But tonight, we're going to be trying to draw a lot of stuff together. I've spoken with Jack over the years about many, many fascinating things, and tonight we're going to see where we've got with it all and see if we can't draw it all into some kind of single story, because that's certainly the way it's looking to me. How's things going with you, Jack? You okay, mate?
Nah, sod off. I've changed my mind. Mate, coming up there.
Oh, come on! You don't want to commit them to a whole night of Dr. Rock's.
Nick and the good people of People's Internet Radio. How the hell are you all?
It's good to have you here.
Don't answer that. Not answer all at once, because we'll never hear you anyway. So.
It's good to have you here, Jack. And you don't really want to commit all of those poor people to a whole night of Dr. Rock's music. So thanks for being here to chat with me, mate.
There's nothing wrong with your tunes. Most.
So, God, it's such a massive thing, isn't it? Because really, really, we're talking about the entire cosmos from the very, very biggest right down
I suppose let's just kind of break this down. If anybody caught the show with me and Vin a Sunday or two ago, where we covered electrobiology and electric universe theory at some length, essentially what me and Nick are proposing for tonight is hopefully a further exploration of those kind of subjects, but not covering most of the same ground. We will cover some of the same ground, but largely this is more coming from me and Nick's kind of field of speciality, where we have common ground. And I think this is where we're very complementary on this, is that really kind of your research and my research have kind of ended up paralleling each other, haven't they?
Well, they have, yeah. And what's amazing about it for me is that I've been blathering on about the geometry now in public arenas since 2007, 2008, perhaps. And it's always been a bit of a mystery as to why it is the way it is. And you seem to be digging into that actual area. We're starting to find out why everything is geometry, which I find
so tremendous. Essentially that's the kind of running title for the show, isn't it? Is like, why sacred geometry, or yeah. Why geometry full stop?
Yeah, I guess so. You know, it appears to be absolutely everywhere, and for the first time I think we're actually getting some sort of insight into why that might be the case. So I guess it'd be a good idea to start with what we were chatting about, must be a couple of years or so, maybe a year or so ago now, which is right back at the very beginning. And
we have been through an awful lot of research together, haven't we? I mean, you've been in all of my research groups and have been keeping up the whole way along. I mean, I dread to think how many pages of reading that must involve and how many videos you must have watched by now.
Yeah, but the thing is with your video links is they're always actually worth watching, which is more than could be said from what I get from everywhere else.
Well, see, there's nobody's bloody going there. I might as well plug it here. If you ever get bored of YouTube, or what the usual kind of recommendations from YouTube are, just Google or YouTube, open Omniversity, and that's my alternate YouTube channel, not where I particularly post my work. It's more a playlist-derived channel, and it's essentially a sort of go-to resource on the internet for vetted videos. So you'll find, you should find every single link on there, both entertaining, educational, and inspiring.
And don't be frightened by them would be my advice as well, because
With each playlist topic, I've done my very best to try and assemble from the most basic of basic principles to the best, general discussion of the larger topic. So I've tried to take each topic and assemble a playlist that will take you lead you by the nose through from the primary principles through to the more advanced stuff, and you can stop wherever you want.
And I think
there's even a four kids playlist, an Omniversity kids playlist, which is all vetted videos. Basically, they're educational videos, but your kids ain't going to notice. Trust me.
And it's a good idea to kick off with them, would be my advice.
Mm.
One of the things about the YouTube is that although...
Well, of course, the first one that I put in the kids section is the Nature by Numbers, the Ioli. I can't remember the name of the chap who did it now. But the one with the dragonfly and the nautilus shell at the beginning.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the one that basically explores Fibonacci and Phi in such a beautiful, illustrative and beautifully animated way.
One of the great things, I think, about these YouTube clips as well is that you can get top-flight people who are doing really quite complicated work. They sometimes use words that you might not easily be able to understand, but they're generally accompanied by animations that really help to make sense of the semantics, as it were. And generally, I find that a couple of watches, the first one, some of it will go, and the second one, you'll understand a lot more.
Essentially, with an animation, if a picture is worth 1,000 words, then an animation must be worth 1,000,000.
Yeah.
I mean, you've taken that two-dimensional compounding of syntax into the third dimension. And added time to it, you know what I mean? So if a picture can save 1,000 words, then an animation must save 1,000,000.
Yeah, yeah, here we go. Cult of the Moving Meats kicked us off nicely there. He's gone, electric universe all sounds well and good, assuming there is such a thing as a universe.
Well, just on that subject, I'm always oft repeating that on hearing Descartes, I think, therefore I am. Personally, I think, therefore I may be. Well, yeah. I think, therefore, perhaps I am.
Yeah, I find myself...
We don't want to be too fundamentalist about it, do we?
Well, we certainly don't, because everything appears to be so uncertain, and especially the levels of information that we're getting, that we could...
He's actually raised a key point there, is that, first of all, we should really outline here that the map is not the territory, and that's certainly another mantra that I think anybody that's researching or looking into these fields need to oft repeat to themselves. Because it's very easy to believe that the discoveries that you're making intellectually and philosophically may be all very self-coherent and assemble into a semblance of sense, but if you can't take that and model anything from it, it's meaningless. Yeah, it might have value to you, but essentially on the broader scale of things, it's meaningless. So you have to essentially create a map of the territory that you're trying to explore. And a map doesn't contain all of the data points. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a map. It would be the territory. Yeah?
Yeah.
And you don't want your A to Z to have every single detail about bloody London in it, because it would be impossible to navigate the roads. There wouldn't be enough room on the page to contain all the information. So essentially, you're looking at a process, something that they call in science Occam's razor, which is the process of removing extraneous levels of complexity in order to reduce a subject to its irreducible core, but without removing so much that the irreducible core becomes corrupted.
And when we're looking at physics, we're actually looking at a science which kind of has three chunks to it, doesn't it? It's got the micro, it's got the visible level where we are, and then it's got the macro, and they appear to have, very complicated models for each of those three areas, but they've got serious problems when they try to plug the three of them together.
I think they've got serious problems fundamentally with each of those areas of dogma as well, because that's what they broadly are. Because unless your theory has a foundation, then it's not a theory, it's a supposition.
Quite so. And
And this is really where we're at with physics today. Since the Copenhagen Agreement of the 1920s, where Einstein and Bose and all the, and Bohm and all the rest of them all agreed on the quantum model as being the most appropriate model for the sort of fundamental particles, and that's kind of where the whole sort of atomic research field came into existence, that essentially they excluded so much that had been theorized and quite respectably theorized. I mean, even Einstein went to his death having never really made up his mind about whether there was an ether or not. He'd included it and excluded it from so many of his various calculations at various points. I'm surprised that he could even keep up with where his calculations were, whether they had an ether or not have an ether. And in the end, he ended up having to add almost like a buoyant force of mystery into the galaxy to explain the absence of the bloody ether.
And, of course, he was introducing ether when it was useful and then de-introducing it when it was no longer useful.
And I think, I mean, we referred to Stephen Carruthers' work in the show with Vin on the other Sunday, but I was forced to not explore his work too deeply because asymptotic curves and R0 objects tends to put people off a little. But just to kind of point out that there is one of the scientists working alongside of the Electric Universe guys, the Thunderbox of the Gods Project people, an Australian chap by the name of Stephen Carruthers, has actually gone back to the, and he does the maths. He's actually one of the few people that can do the bloody maths. And he's gone back in and actually looked at the definitions for each of the terms that are being used in stuff like the quantum model. And essentially, when you query the actual terms themselves, there's a huge level of confusion just about the most simple thing, like a radius. There's no agreement on what a radius consists of.
Well, if you're going to start off with a circle with a radius of zero, you've clearly got a problem.
Well, basically, yeah. Well, what they're actually, I mean, just to put this into context, just so that people can really understand it, is virtually everybody to this day will now probably have seen the rubber mat model of gravity with the, you know, I mean, the heavy sun in the middle of the rubber mat and making a big dent, and the planets sort of around it making slightly smaller dents, and everything sort of rolls in a very gravitational-like way. But the only problem with that whole premise of this is somehow an explanation of what gravity is that they're using gravity to explain gravity, because the pulling down of the thing into the rubber mat is being done by the force of gravity acting from underneath. And, of course, that just simply can't explain gravity. That's like trying to explain a foot by saying, well, it's the same length as a foot.
Yeah,
it just doesn't work. There's no modelling being done there. So again, this is what I'm saying about the theories aren't theories because they're not based on a foundation. You have to have a foundation on which to base a theory. Otherwise, it's a premise, it's a supposition, it's an assumption. Now, the thing is, with the quantum model, the working assumption has been so fantastically predictive because of the fine mathematicians that have plied their trade against it for so many years. And, OK, a lot of it has ended up in the realm of mathemagics, as I like to call it, or the realm of mathemagicians, summoning forces and elements that simply don't exist just because it fits their maths. But in that, you know what I mean, we have the whole electronics revolution. We have the silicon revolution. We have lasers. We have the internet. None of these things would be possible without the accuracy of the quantum model to map reality. But again, the problem is that at the end of the day, the quantum model is not a bloody theory. It's a premise because there's no foundation. There's no knowledge of where mass comes from, of where the force of gravity acts from. And again, I mean, this is one of the beauties of the Electric Universe model is it does away with the force of gravity. It now becomes the effect of gravity. It has exactly the same implications when it comes to the mass of orbital objects, you know, I mean, interplanetary geometry and stuff like this is all still exactly the same, but it's no longer some mysterious force that has to have some source, because we now know what the source is. The source is the asymmetric orbit of the electron around the proton, making every single atom in the universe a slight dipole.
In a small, of course. Every
single atom in the universe has a kind of bar magnet effect where it's got a north and south pole because the electrons aren't circling in a circular orbit around it. They're slightly off center.
But really, even the word atom and the word particle are fundamentally misleading, aren't they?
Well, I mean, certainly the whole kind of Hadron Collider bloody LHC. Collider. Large Hadron Collider. It's the biggest machine for siphoning money out of the European Union taxpayers' pocket ever invented.
250,000 physicists. You've got to do something
really,
with them.
I'm really quite pissed off that I didn't think of it first.
And why do you need something so absolutely massive to look for things that are so tiny?
Well, the point being that what they're actually doing is they're taking two fine Swiss watches, they're accelerating them to near the speed of light, and then they're smashing them into each other and somehow expecting that the pile of bits that they're going to have left afterwards is going to be able to explain to them how a Swiss watch worked.
And then better still,
with the Large Hadron Collider, they're not happy that the Swiss watch is now like exploding into gears and cogs and jewels and springs. But then they're taking those gears, cogs and jewels and springs and accelerating them to light speed and smashing them together in the hope that somehow perhaps that's going to explain how a Swiss watch works.
And, of course, because of the measurement problem, they don't actually get to see the cogs and wheels and springs. All they get to see is where they might have been.
Anybody that's looking at a cloud chamber can see that what you appear to be witnessing there is some sort of an effect, not a particle. So it's, you know what I mean, this whole, you know what I mean, point particle thing, we're possibly looking at more like a little miniature vortex. If the electron is anything, it's like a little tornado, but there's nothing in the middle. Which then really begs the question as what is matter? And to me, it has to be kind of constantly, perpetually moving electrical fields.
Yeah, and I mean, one of the things that's whilst I was looking into all the links,
I think to be quite honest, we've probably got a bit of ahead of ourselves here. We were actually supposed to be going process fractals, you know.
Yeah, well, we will get there.
Should we wind back a few steps and start with some Stephen Wolfram and work our way back up again?
Why not? That was the idea, was to start right with the very simple beginnings and these...
How far in are we? Oh, it's all right, we're only half an hour in.
It always happens with you, Jack. It's always... The thing is that almost anything you touch on, we've touched on, like, quantum theory and the fact that... It's something of an excuse for a theory, but at the same time, at least apparently, it's enabled all of our electronics and things like that. Is it really quantum theory that's responsible for that?
No, largely it's the maths derived from quantum theory. So quantum theory doesn't really do a great deal to help your average, CPU manufacturer a CPU. But when it comes down to, essentially we're reaching the fundamental limits for CPUs now at the 7-nanometer process. And with only 7-nanometer boundaries between each of the circuits on the silicon wafer, we're now getting something called quantum tunneling, where the electron won't stay in the pipe that it's put in. It'll jump to the one next to it. And again, this is a huge problem for science. You know what I mean? The fact that electrons can disappear from one point in solid space and reappear somewhere else where there wasn't actually a gap for it to travel through or anything electrically conductive for it to find an electrical path through kind of is a bit tricky.
Yeah, an aspect that I have never been happy with.
The Bose-Einstein condensate is supposed to be made up of atoms that are literally fluxing in and out of existence at an almost random kind of fluxation where literally atoms jump in and out of existence on a random kind of materialization and dematerialization. And I find these sort of things very hard to accept as being even likely to be true.
Well, if anything lends the lie to the material nature of matter, then that's probably it, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, there certainly is that aspect to it. Anyway, we still haven't... Let's rewind... Back to process fractals.
Right to the
let's
very
start
beginning.
Beginning and work our way up, shall we? Yeah, I mean, this is really one of the first places that my work started was with Stephen Wolfram's A New Kind of Science, where he gave seminars on his book, which was based on something that he describes as Mathematica. And the subject of Mathematica and his book, A New Kind of Science, was an examination of the nature of mathematics with numbers removed largely from the study. So essentially it's a study of the nature of mathematics, but not from necessarily a human perspective with the sort of 0 to 9 numbering system. So it's number, but it's number that's being implied rather than implicitly stated as an arbitrary kind of numbering system.
So he's trying to look at the thing that number does its best to describe.
Exactly. So he's trying to look at the thing rather than the character that we associate with it. And in his study of this, he came across a field of maths that's been around for quite some time called process fractals. Now, to explain, a process fractal is essentially a way of doing maths, but without number. So essentially, in order to replace number in the sort of in the flow of mathematics, in process fractals, you would have, say, like a checkerboard, but instead of having black and white squares, it would just be a sort of a grey lattice grid. And onto this grey lattice grid, with each row that you move forward, that's an algebraic iteration. So you start on the top row, let's say, and you put one black square. And there'll be a rule for this particular process fractal, which will be one black square in amongst four white squares is one, right, is the start point. And then there'll be a plus, a minus, a divide, a times, and then another four squares with some number of black or white squares on it. And this is basically the algebraic rule that this particular process fractal is adhering to. So with each iteration, that particular multiply, divide by, add, whatever, of the numbers of black and white squares from the second function becomes the first iteration. So the second row on your checkerboard now becomes the first iteration, the first time that the algebra is applied to the initial state. And by simply just reiterating and reiterating and reiterating, so basically applying the same mathematic algebra to this, to the checkerboard as it comes towards you, you end up with this normally regular patterned device, shall we say. You know, I mean, it could be an entire like sort of triangle, like a pyramid of checkerboard black and white squares. So every other square is black and every other square is white, forming a nice smooth 45-degree pyramid coming out from the original one black square initiator. And that's really the standard fare for the process fractal. They tend to generate very regular-looking patterns. Sometimes they'll look like they're beginning to become irregular, but then they'll fall back into regularity again. But what Wolfram discovered was that he was one of the first working in computer maths, and he was able to load all of the known process fractals that were available with this simple checkerboard design and the four square number units going into it. I think there's something like 236 possible combinations of that particular square grid and of those particular units of four, black and white, you know, I mean, with blacks and whites. And what he found was that by running all of these sequentially in one of the first sort of domestic computers or sort of, you know, I mean, mainframe computers, was that he was able to allow these process fractals to just run for the sort of lengths of time that a handwritten mathematician just simply couldn't ply that amount of time into. And what he discovered was that certain of these rule sets aren't as regular as they appear to be, and certainly aren't as regular as their initiating state would suggest, because their initiating state doesn't actually impart any intrinsic sort of chaotic function. Sorry, dog's tail. Doesn't actually impart any sort of chaotic function to the subsequent iterations, and yet chaos appears to fall out of those iterations regardless of what the initiating state is. And he began to realise that what he was seeing falling out on the page with a certain number of the rule sets were very organic and very biological-looking forms. And so, you know, I mean, this is kind of the basis for fractal geometry, is this repeating, reiterating algebra. So basically you take a 1 plus 2 equals 3, yeah, and you just simply keep reapplying the plus whatever part of that sum to the output, and that's how we derive Fibonacci. Fibonacci is a fractal algebraic equation. It's 1 plus 1 equals 2, 2 plus 1 equals 3, 3 plus 2. So basically what you're doing is you're taking the sum of 1 plus, yeah, and then after the equals sign, where you would end up with 1 plus 1 equals 2, that's your iteration. So that's the iteration of the fractal algebra, and that's your sum of that iteration.
So basically, the result on one side of the equal sign gets fed back into the equation on the left side of the equal sign, and it feeds itself effectively.
And that's how fractals are all generated. Now, the complexity of the fractal now comes down to the manner of that algebra. For stuff like the Mandelbrot set, which is obviously a very complicated fractal, when you look at it, it's actually a very simple bit of algebra that does the Mandelbrot set. It's been known about that Mandelbrot was a French mathematician in the 1890s, and he'd never seen the Mandelbrot set. He discovered the algebra, but nobody had ever seen the Mandelbrot set till some spotty kid in 1974 or whatever it was punched it into his dad's mainframe and like sort of crashed the system for a week while it punched out a single screen of the Mandelbrot set.
And actually
the Mandelbrot set is quite a nice way to illustrate this concept of iteration, because if you've ever run Mandelbrot set generators on a computer, and boy are they CPU heavy, those things. But if you ever run a Mandelbrot set generator on a CPU, you'll soon learn about iterations, because essentially if you want to make one of those zooming films of diving into the Mandelbrot,
yeah,
that most people are familiar with, well, every single one of the frames in that sequence is an iteration. So basically your initial frame is the initial algebra just simply applied to a box of a certain size. And then by simply reiterating and reiterating and reiterating that same maths, you'll create a three-dimensional object. You'll create the Mandelbrot set that you can then zoom into.
Where do the colours come from in those? Because when you look at the computer-generated ones, they are truly gorgeous, aren't they? It's like you've got a head full of psychotropics, but it's on your computer screen.
I suspect it's probably a refraction pattern, so very much like a butterfly's wings, where there's no actual colour there at all. The colour that you're seeing is simply generated almost by your eyes and the nearness of the lines. So basically the lines are so close together that they affect the frequency of the light as it hits your eyes.
Mm-hmm. Because I used to have a fractal.
I could be wrong about that with the Mandelbrot set pictures. It may well be colorized to some degree or not. I don't know. But certainly with some of the work that I've done in video, it's very easy to induce that sort of a coloration on a black and white image just simply by phase shifting the image. So you overlay two of the same black and white video over the top of each other, and just simply time shift the two video signals by a frame or so, and you'll often see colours emerging that just simply aren't there in the video. They're being generated by the interplay of the two different refraction patterns, the differential grids between the two images.
Yeah.
That's the simple two-dimensional process fractal.
It's basically a very simple equation that generates over time extremely complicated and regular and sometimes very three-dimensional looking patterns, just exactly the kind of thing that we see around us.
And certainly probably looks like the most Occam's razor core principle of what organics is. It appears to be a self-repeating fractal of some relatively simple nature, that just by simply continually reapplying itself and re-entering the product into the initiator, so basically by taking the stuff after the equals and putting it back in at the start, you generate a seemingly unnatural level of complexity from something that looks to our eyes to be really simple.
And there's not many of them either, are there? And some of them work, like you say, somewhere under 250, and some of them work a lot better than others.
Well, there's really only the one that does the... It's the... Rule 23, Rule 25, it's somewhere up around there. It's in the 20s or the 30s out of the 200 and something, or otherwise, is the one that's really kind of very interesting, because that one just breaks down into an organic-looking picture almost immediately once it starts, and there's nothing particularly remarkable about its initiating phase.
And if people put the word cellular automata into a search engine, that will come up with pictures of some of these things.
Mm. Moreover, I think it was Wolfram that was doing the research that where they were actually using cellular automata to sort of map crowd behavior and things like this on the very first early computers, where they just simply didn't have enough number crunching capacity to do anything more than black dots and white dots on a square grid.
Oh, I didn't realize it was usable for that sort of thing, because I know they're really, although it's extremely difficult to predict the path of a single individual through something like a crowded railway station, they're actually pretty bloody good at telling where people as a whole are going to go, and the more people they've got, the easier it is to come up with accurate answers. Is this the technique they're using for doing that?
Pretty much, yeah, and this was certainly one of the earliest ones, and I believe that Wolfram was actually the research fellow that was working on this particular subject when they were using, they were running like battle scenarios to see if the computer could come up with better sort of battlefield rationale, sort of logic. And so they were pitting sort of black squares against white squares in this computer simulation. And so essentially you've got a checkerboard with a bunch of black squares on one side and a bunch of white squares on the other side, and they kind of meet in the middle, and if enough black squares can surround a white square, it's taken off the board. If enough white squares can surround a black square, it's taken off the board. And they put certain parameters into the two opposing sort of sides to make it sort of a bit more realistic as a kind of representation of a battle of sorts. And one day, apparently, he had one of these running on a computer sort of by the side of him, not the main one that he was working on, because it was just number crunching and there's nothing particularly going on. So he's working on this other terminal, and he's ended his shift and he's turned off the terminal that he's working at, and he's spun around and he's about to turn the terminal off that was running the process fractals beside him. And these two supposedly warring black and white sides had collaborated and climbed off the screen.
They'd escaped.
Yeah.
Oh, that sound. I mean, to start and with, honest,
couldn't quite make up his mind whether to turn the computer off that night, because he wasn't sure if he'd just seen the first artificial light form.
That description of kind of a battlefield and using these techniques for managing that, like moving people through a railway station or whatever, is quite scary. But the idea that it could eventually leave the screen and break free is interesting, isn't it?
Well, and moreover, I think this is actually indicative that because we have this kind of consciousness and this this kind of apparence of free will and of choice, that we assume that the universe must run to some kind of freewheeling kind of, well, if you choose to do it, you can do it kind of thing. And it really doesn't appear to do that on the grander, on the larger scale and on the smaller scale. It appears to run almost like clockwork, and it appears to run to an arithmetic and an algebraic and a geometric nature. And so, like you say, the larger number of people that you're studying, the easier it is to predict, because they'll begin to act like flocks of birds, and they'll begin to adopt certain geometric forms and certain algebraic flows that will be very predictable.
And Mike, I mean, the thing that interested me about this when we first talked about it is that it sounds, at least to my untutored mind, like a more possible start for everything than your zero radius sphere just exploding and everything else coming out of it.
Absolutely, and that's where my numerical flux and the computational mainframe really starts from, is it starts from the premise that there could never have been any real Big Bang, and that if there has been an expansion into the complexity that we see for today from some simpler form, that initial simpler form probably wasn't even multidimensional. It was probably single-dimensional.
Just like the geometry suggests.
Precisely. And so the first time that we actually arrive at anything that would remotely approach something that we could consider as reality as we perceive it today would be when the first tetrahedral form came together.
Yeah, the simplest of the 3D forms. Mm.
And in my numerical flux and the computational mainframe, I do my very best to describe a potential mechanism, again, talking about a map, not the territory people, talking about a potential substrate on which the holographic universe can actually be computated, and it is dependent on the nature of geometry and the interplay of geometry. And essentially, the premise is that instead of the data field that would be responsible for generating some sort of a realistic three-dimensional hologram that we all appear to occupy, that it wouldn't be computed in linear form. It's, you know, I mean, the whole linear computation thing is simply a construct of our human way of thinking. We read from left to right, we do maths from left to right. When we write computer code, we write from left to right in lines. You know, everyone's heard of lines of computer code. Well, my suggestion is this, that the substrate of reality is in fact a three-dimensional computational surface. And what we experience as consciousness is in fact our personal geometry, which is attached to all of the other geometries in the universe by kind of strings of data, of inputs and outputs, of ones and zeros, of strings of algebra, of numbers and sequences. And these essentially encode the vibrations into the 3D reality that we experience as this kind of holographic reality.
And like you say, the numbers are merely our way of representing it. There is actually a more fundamental movement happening.
Yeah, there's definitely a oneness and a two-ness about a single object and a dual object. I mean, inherent without the characters one or two being associated with them, which is essentially the concept behind process fractals, is that instead of using arbitrary numbering systems, they're using the onenesses and the twonesses and the onness and offness of the black and the white to represent what we perceive as ones and twos.
And when we talk about a hologram,
I mean, there's a lot of discussion at the moment in the realm of sort of higher maths of, is maths invented or is it discovered?
Yes, because, of course, it has been believed for some time that maths is the only truth by some people, isn't it?
Well, I've oft repeated that, you know, in sociology is derived from psychology is derived from biology is derived from chemistry is derived from physics, and physics is derived from maths.
Right, yes, I'd never heard it put quite that way. I've always seen physics put at the middle. It must be some other people I've seen doing the model, but... Yeah.
I think I have to credit either Johnny Meath or Donegal for that one. Can't lay claim to that little bit of wisdom.
No, well done. That's a good one. Putting the maths inside the physics. I like that.
Mm.
And it does appear to be kind of stacked up that way, and you can sort of imagine how your process fractals might start.
And I suppose I would actually suggest that beneath the maths is even a more fundamental thing of logic, reason, and grammar. I mean, logic, rhetoric, and grammar, rather. And yeah, that there's something about the interaction of mind, matter, and re-expressing, reinterpreting that back out into the world that appears to be some integral process of reality.
It certainly does.
And that this is, I mean, essentially, and so what we've done here is we've built a bridge from this sort of two-dimensional simplification of reality as this two-dimensional process fractal being run along a linear sequence of algebra in a very human construct to an actual a three-dimensional an objective reality made up of three-dimensional geometric structures that are either dynamically connected to each other physically or possibly just simply connected to each other through sort of nodal points and resonant collection. And essentially, I can see the computational surface perhaps as a platonic solid, where each point is an input or an output receiver or transmitter, and each line is a line of algebra. And so each data stream, as it reaches that corner, is going to input data at that point, but that data is going to be acted on differently by each of the lines coming from that point. And so effectively you're going to end up with a kind of a resonant geometric structure that is exchanging information with itself and running calculations, essentially, but that these calculations are not going to be some intended thing, some thought-up thing. They're going to be calculations that are fundamental to the nature of reality. So they're likely to be Faraday's law, Maxwell's law, you know what I mean? Gauss's law. They're going to be the algebra that make electrostatics, electromagnetics.
Okay. that actually describe the energetic nature of the thing we're living in.
Well, and this is kind of where we step onto your field of speciality, really, with the platonic solids, with the geometries. And this is the kind of the why geometry and the why sacred geometry of it all, is that we were saying off air that essentially that geometry is the evidence of a false acting. And that's why geometry, the reason why we see the geometries that we do, is because that false tends to only act, well, false does only act through straight lines. And because we live in a sort of spherical universe where force is acting on all sides on most things, fairly in sort of fair equilibrium, any substance that you act on with a force in equilibrium will adopt one of the geometric forms.
Which is certainly the way it seems to happen. Before we hit,
and I would suggest that on a planetary scale, that form is actually football shaped. It's the truncated dodecahedron that we use to make footballs out of. And I would suggest that the reason why we see the sort of nodal points on the energy grid of the Earth, why the sort of ancients placed their stone structures at those strategic places, and why those places appear to be in geometric kind of alignment with each other when there's no way of understanding how those peoples could possibly have sighted that thing with such accuracy, it's simply because they were able to detect those particular energy nodes near to the surface, because you would have had springs or volcanoes or whatever coming out of the ground there. But that's just the point at which the geometry intersects the sphere.
It's also a point of complexity, isn't it? Because we're aware, because of the what I think it's called, the tetrahedral constant, the fact that a tetrahedron put inside a sphere, like say a planet, is going to have 3 points. If you've got your tetrahedron pointing to the top of the sphere, the base of the tetrahedron is going to be 19.5 degrees below the equator, below the center of the sphere, and there will be 3 points on the surface of the sphere that are actively expressing that tetrahedral force in there, and we can see that.
Lots of the things that we see in the solar system, certainly lots of the sort of massive things that we see, sort of sunspots occur at that latitude and at the higher and lower latitudes, generally at that angle, the Jupiter's red spots there, Olympus Mons on Mars. What do we have on Earth? I think the
Easter Island, is it?
Well,
can't remember.
I know that, yeah, there's certainly a lot of correlation geometrically between the sort of major geomagnetic features on planets and that sort of internal geometric structure. And again, there's nothing mysterious about this geometric structure. If you take a ball, if you take a sphere and you squeeze it from all sides, the lines of force that travel through it will be dodecahedral. There'll be a truncated dodecahedron. There'll be a football. Or a deflated football. So if you take the hexagons and the pentagons that are stitched together to make a football, the reason why they use that particular set of geometries is because when you inflate the ball, that's the only one that will create a perfect sphere.
I mean,
because
is the football actually a truncated dodecahedron?
Or it's a slight modification on it because of the requirements of actually putting the ball inside the skin and then inflating it and all the rest of it. But essentially, the geometry holds true. So the reason why a football is spherical rather than rugby ball shaped, yeah, is because the pressure distribution across each of those patches is in perfect. Dog with a cat. Is in perfect pressure distribution. Yeah, so on each of the seams and on each of the surfaces, you have exactly the same pressure and force acting in all directions.
So you end up with something that's a little bit.
And so essentially, what we see there is that what's happening on planets, but turned inside out, we're pumping a football up and inflating it from the inside. Well, planets have been sort of crushed from the outside by gravity. So the lines of force that run through the core of the Earth must take up a truncated dodecahedral form in order to follow the paths of least resistance, in order to be in pressure equilibrium.
Yeah.
So I would suggest that, in fact, what we're seeing with the people that are suggesting that that's from a star tetrahedron, from two tetrahedra inserted sort of head and tails into each other, is possibly a misnomer, and that they're slightly missing the point. And as you know from your sacred geometry, you put a star tetrahedron inside a truncated dodecahedron. Do the points match up?
Ooh, that's a nesting I've not tried. They probably would. They would,
caught
wouldn't
you
they?
Out.
Yeah, got me.
Caught out the great geometer. He doesn't know, people.
Well,
geometer doesn't know.
The thing is, there are an infinity of nestings even amongst the platonics.
Well, precisely, and even if it's not a specific nesting inside the truncated dodecahedron, we know that there'll be an in-between geometry that does perfectly nest the three together.
Yeah.
So if a star tetrahedron doesn't match exactly the points of a truncated dodecahedron when you put the one inside the other, then there'll be an intermediary geometry of one of the platonic solids, one of the known geometric forms, that will essentially bridge the two geometries.
Which is, of course, how we get away with having five platonic forms and 13 Archimedean forms, is because of those nestings, because of the way they communicate with each other and fit within each other, is how come we get away with so few. Because we are.
And if anybody wants to sort of get a clearer image of this, go onto YouTube and just Google YouTube Metatron's Cube. That's Metatrons, Metatron's Cube. And he was the Archangel Metatron.
Yeah, and that will show you how even on a two.
Well, that's all of the platonic geometries, all nested, and all nested according to a geometric. Embedding.
What's more, with our eyes and our reception systems, you can do it on a, you can do it as a plane and still see all of the 3D geometries there.
Hmm. Yes, of course. Yeah. Because you can extrapolate the third dimension, can't you?
Yeah. So, do we reckon all of the spheres we see around us have probably got that same the truncated dodecahedron?
I can only think that they must. There may be additional geometries, more complex geometries within that structure, but I think that the primary energy structure of every planetary object is probably truncated dodecahedral. And I think this possibly explains the hexagonal cloud formation on Saturn. I think that essentially is all that you're seeing there is you're seeing the north pole of Saturn happens to align with the hexagonal face of its internal truncated dodecahedron.
Yeah, and we've seen them in other places.
So essentially the clouds are just simply following the natural lines of force that are there on every planet. It's just that you don't normally see that sort of perfect alignment of a north pole with the dead centre of the underlying geometry.
And that basically is, given that we're talking about something planet-sized and all of that, it's a very basic geometry to find inside something that's so huge and complicated.
Mm. Yeah, and to me, to my mind as well, it explains an awful lot about, you know what I mean, the sort of sighting of volcanoes and you know what I mean, geological stuff.
Yes.
And also probably goes a long way to explaining how the ancients were able to place these sites within such incredibly close, you know what I mean, alignments with each other without possibly ever being able to align them. It's because they weren't aligning them with each other. They were just simply placing them on points on this geometric grid. And because they were able to place them with reasonable accuracy on that grid, on their local bit of the grid, that because the grid is geometric, then of course there's going to be straight lines in between them.
They must have had a fair idea that they were living on a sphere in order to be able to do that.
I think this whole, you know, I mean, can we not do that?
Yeah, that's a good idea. Let's not do that.
Let's not do that. Thank you, Eric. Thank you for any energy. You should be ashamed of yourself, young man.
So that means we kicked off with these little black and white squares and the process fractals and a very few number of rules that can be applied to them to create complex effects. We've moved into the third dimension and recognised that the fundamental shapes that appear to be used in the creation or manifestation of absolutely everything are extremely limited. They're limited basically to 18 forms. There are others, but they're all related to those 18. When we talk about a hologram and a holographic reality, normally, although a hologram looks 3D to our senses, it is actually a plane, isn't it? And what's more, it's a plane of meaningless swirls.
Specifically, a hologram isn't actually a plane object. A holographic plate, regardless of being a thin glass plate, is in fact a three-dimensional object. And this is where a lot of people get this wrong, is that the holograms that we see as three-dimensional are not on a two-dimensional object. And it's the understanding of how the two lasers and their interference pattern create a three-dimensional reference. Basically, they create a frozen data set within the body of the glass. So because the glass is sort of impregnated with a photographic medium, they shine these lasers. You shine two lasers at a single object, and you illuminate an object with two lasers that are shone through something called an interferometer. So essentially, these lasers are coming out as like fingers of light that are crossing over each other. And essentially, where these fingers of light cross over each other, every crossing over point is a data point in the three-dimensional space. Now, when that light now enters the photographic plate that's taking the hologram, these basically cross over again, and the crossing over point within the glass itself encodes that three-dimensional grid reference.
Right, so
that can only be done through the depth of the glass.
Okay, so the hologram is as thick as the glass.
Yes.
Ah, I never knew that.
So it's not actually a two-dimensional object. It is a three-dimensional object, but it is taking the depth of field of the three dimensions that you see in it and compressing it to an inconceivable narrowness. And the amount of information that can be compressed into that glass plate. I mean, bearing in mind that you can smash a glass hologram plate on the floor and pick up every single individual broken bit of glass and see the entire hologram in it.
Yeah.
You have to rotate around, and you have to kind of like squint to see into the smaller bits. But trust me, every single bit has all the information of the entire image and three dimensions.
That explains to me why the depth of the image is still there. But okay, well, just kind of advance that argument a little bit. The glass is still flattened of a given thickness, yet the hologram looks to us to be not like that.
And this is because it's a data compression. Basically, it's taking the data of the depth of the field of image and the width of the field of image, and it's compressing it down into the glass plate, and it's condensing it in such a way that when that plate is re-illuminated with a laser light, which is being sent through an interferometer, it recreates the data beyond the plate. So the actual image that you're seeing isn't in the plate. It's actually replaced into its three-dimensional perspective.
So when we talk about reality as a
hologram, that's the hologram that I'm talking about, not these silly bloody stage-generated fake mirror tricks that they do and make you think that Michael Jackson's come back to life. They're not holograms. That's smoke and mirrors stuff from the 18th century.
So are we looking at a reality that's...
So when we talk about... So basically, when we talk about holographic reality, what we're actually describing is the high-definition, three-dimensional appearance of reality that we perceive with our consciousness is not actually quite how we perceive it, and it is most likely condensed down to a much, much smaller information set in which all of the information of the greater information set is somehow compressed. And the only way that I can conceive of that compression being taken place is through the compression that can be achieved through using fractal geometry. So essentially, the algebra of the fractals is the compression of the data. So by taking a very wide field of data and applying fractal geometry, basically feeding it backwards through the Mandelbrot set and ending up back at your first iteration, and then by taking the Mandelbrot set, turning it round and projecting back the other way, you get the full information returned. So essentially, you're taking the entire Mandelbrot set that you can travel through for hours on end. You can sail through the Mandelbrot set. You can go into all the little zooms, all the little swirls. You can keep going basically to infinity. The Mandelbrot set is an infinite fractal. Yeah. Well, it's essentially a small line of algebra. So all of that data that you've just been perceiving as depth and of color and of shape is just a set of numbers. It's and a set of numbers and a few pluses and minuses. I should actually pull up what the Mandelbrot set is, the algebra for it, because it's remarkably small.
Yeah, it is. Like I say, it's an algorithmic set with actually very few numbers in it and very, very
And all
simple.
of that complexity is simply derived from the number of iterations. And this is really how reality comes about, is because the frame rate is so bloody fast. I mean, Tom Campbell puts it down at a 10 to the minus 64, which is basically a naught, a point, a naught, 64 noughts and a one of a second. Yeah, so every second there's whatever it is, 64 billion, 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 billion bits of a second to make up that second. And it's so many that we could never even conceive of the number of iterations that are going on through the fractal in every second, let alone every minute and every hour.
And
So
in
the
fact,
complexity.
when you look at one of those what they call Necker cubes, you know, a cube that's drawn just with black lines on a piece of white paper, so that you can either see the one square as the front of the cube or the other
Yeah, and they
square.
flip backwards and forwards. It looks like
But
they're turning inside out.
that's right. But we can only do that. Even apparently, if we're really well trained, we can only make that kind of shift about 5 or 6 times a second, which is our individual frame rate. That's our perceptual frame rate, how much of this mass of stuff we can actually see.
Well, and we've, you know, I mean, beautifully segued again into where we were wanting to go with this whole frame of reference thing, because this is another thing, is that we're talking about these rigid geometries, these linear and angular things, as if they actually exist in reality, when in fact nothing exists in straight lines in nature. Because the only reason why we perceive anything as being a fixed point or a straight line is because our frame of reference is moving at exactly the same time as the thing that we're observing. If we actually perceived the thing as it really is, it would be drawing infinite numbers of spirals.
Yes, indeed. The spiral thing is really key. I'll tell
I
you
mean,
what.
take, for example, my beer glass that I keep picking up off the table here. Fortunately, I'm able to reliably reach out and grab it each time, even though it's travelling at approximately 17,000 miles an hour.
Yeah,
But
I always
because
knew
I'm
you
travelling at
shot.
exactly the same 17,000 miles an hour and in exactly the same direction, to my frame of reference, the beer glass appears to be stationary. But the beer glass is anything but bloody stationary.
Yes. Let's.
It's
I'll
on the
tell you what,
surface of
we've
a
got.
rotating sphere, which is in an orbit around a solar object, which is in a binary system with another solar object. So we've got so many spirals upon spirals upon spirals, it's really hard to actually imagine it from the human context.
Yeah, although actually looking at the long body of the sun and how the sun and the planets move through space, those animations they do, you can get some idea of that. I'll tell you what, we're probably coming up to a music break. There's a
Go on,
couple
Ed.
of questions and a comment that look like they're coming from Cult of the
Ah,
Moving
sod
Meat.
'em. I ain't interested.
Well,
Unenlightened minds. Bah, humbug.
first of all, Vin has put Zn plus 1 equals Z times 2 over N plus C, which I presume is the Mandelbrot
Got a bit
set,
of
is it?
Mandelbrot set, hasn't it? Yeah, well, there you go. It really is like that small to make all of that complexity. And again, the Mandelbrot set is only two-dimensional.
Yeah, although you'd
The
never believe
appearance
that
of
to
three
look at it.
dimensions just appears through the iterations. It's still every single one of those frames is a two-dimensional frame.
And it doesn't look 2D to us, that's the thing. That's another interesting thing about all of this. Cult of the Moving Meat, who I think, I'm not sure, is it Jimmy? Not sure, might be. Anyway, Cult of the Moving
Stop
Meat.
changing your bloody usernames on the
You
chat, you gits. I never know who's who.
I don't either, mate. I find it very difficult to keep up.
Yes,
He's put
stop it at once. Be a name and stick with it.
He's put, could the information of the universe be transmitted via some alternative route which has nothing to do with the corners of platonic solids?
It could, yes, it could be on the surface of a sphere. It could be through a helix. As we're suggesting, it would appear that everything is in motion, and that everything is in motion is essentially drawing spirals. So yes, it could be entirely. But the easiest way to model it is to think of it as a geometric surface, just simply because that allows that Occam's razor of simplification that allows our human brains to kind of fathom it a little bit. The map is not territory.
And of course, the platonic solids tend to be ideal models to which reality approximates rather than absolutely
Exactly, and the same with
adhering.
Fibonacci. All of these people that are claiming to see Fibonacci everywhere in nature, I defy them to go and prove it. Yeah, because it really isn't there. There's bits, there's an approximation, but it's not bloody Fibonacci, and it certainly isn't phi.
That was Plato's whole point, was that these are the ideal forms, and that this is kind of modelled on it, but when you...
Well, they're basically the forms that nature is trying to use.
Yeah.
But nature isn't geometric.
If you look
nature works through spirals. So, again, it's a matter of trying to reduce the complexity to a level where our poor little human brains can possibly consider it.
Yeah. And, of course, Fibonacci and Phi is ideally expressed by the pentagon, which is a fearfully difficult thing to draw accurately. And when you actually look at nature, it tends to...
It's easier to construct, isn't it, than to draw from... Isn't it easier to construct from a circle than to actually draw with a ruler?
Absolutely, yes. Yes, it is.
Now, if you couldn't draw it with a protractor and a ruler particularly, it's much easier to draw it with just by drawing a circle and then to divide the circle into five parts with the...
set of dividers or whatever.
But doing it the old
geometric way involves at least 7 or 8 manoeuvres with your straight edge and your compasses, and tends to, if you're not really, really, really careful, it tends to yield a not perfect pentagon. And all of the geometry, if it's not perfect, just looks crap.
Exactly. It doesn't work as well.
The easiest
anyway,
way...
Anyway, come on, stick on a tune.
Okay.
Let their poor minds just kind of steam a little while
one more question from the meat cult.
Yeah, go on then.
Is Jack suggesting gravity comes from outside a planet?
No.
Good. There's a simple answer to that one.
The asymmetric electron path is simply this, is that the inside and the outside of any ball capacitor will charge separate so that the charges are equally distributed across the entire surface of the ball capacitor. This is assuming a perfectly smooth ball capacitor. So basically any charge that is at a distance r from the center of the ball capacitor will be exactly the same as every other charge at every other point at r from that center.
There you go, cult. That's your answer to that. Now we're
To understand the relationship that we see as the force of gravity is simply that the outside of our particular ball capacitor happens to be positive, which means that the inside of it must be negative. Okay, and that means that every other sphere that we see of like the atmosphere and then the ionosphere and then the zootroposphere or whatever it is, and then the one above that, each one of those will be the same again. So the inside of the sphere will be negative. So the inside of the atmosphere as we perceive it is negative because the surface of the Earth is positive. The outside of the atmosphere will be positive and the inside of the ionosphere negative. And the outside of the ionosphere, yeah? So these spheres of ball capacitance radiate out from any charged object and they radiate out according to a very strict charge separation that like charges repel and unlike charges attract. That all charges on a spherical object achieve equilibrium at r, at the radius. So essentially, when we're standing on the surface of the Earth, all of the atoms in our body are attracted to all of those atoms in the Earth that are all positively charged from our frame of reference because we're standing on the surface, we're not inside. So essentially all of the electrons in our body, which are negatively charged, are attracted equally to every other atom in the Earth. So basically our electrons try to follow an eccentric path and try to be near to that positive charge. Now, because the electrons are on the outside of the atom, of the outside of the nucleus, they're not fixed in space. So they can distort slightly in their orbits, where the nucleus, the positive charge in the middle, is stuck. It's not an orbiting body, or not in the way that we think of it. And so essentially this means that every single atom in our body is essentially like a little magnetic dipole with a negative bottom and a positive top. And all of the negative bottoms are attracted to all of the positive tops of all of the atoms on the planet equally, not just down, but in all directions. And this is why the force of gravity is 36,000 times, or no, it's not even 36... 36 noughts and a one smaller than the electric attraction.
Not what one might have thought, first have thought, eh?
And this, so essentially what we're seeing is we're seeing that every atom in our body is effectively attracted to every other atom in the universe according to the inverse square law, which is an exponential curve, which is, you know how when you put a torch up against a wall And for every one unit that you pull away, the circle of light gets four times bigger and four times dimmer.
Yep.
That's the inverse square law. Well, essentially, that's what's happening on an atomic level, that every single atom in your body is attracted to every single other atom in the universe according to the inverse square law, which is basically a curve that goes to nearly zero, but it never quite meets zero. This is your asymptotic curve. Yeah. So an asymptotic curve is basically a nice parabolic curve that heads from whatever your initiating point is towards zero in a nice smooth curve, but it never actually quite reaches zero. And it never quite goes to parallel. So it basically goes off to infinity and meets somewhere in infinity, but never quite meets. So essentially the atoms on the far side of the universe, you can discount them, you know what I mean? Their effect is so nominal, we could never model it. But everything else within the nearby space, including the sun and all the planets and everything else, are all pulling on the atoms of our body to some degree. And we're in this constant kind of magnetic flux that we perceive as gravity. So it's simply that. It's just simply the asymmetry on an atomic level where electrons can follow an asymmetric path around the nucleus. And because the nucleus carries the positive charge and the electron rings carry the negative charge, and because the electron rings can move but the nucleus can't, then the electrons just simply change it, shift it. A bit like the sun, the Earth does around the sun. It travels in an oval path. It doesn't travel in circles. Well, nor do electrons, for exactly the same reason, because they're being pulled by a larger charge elsewhere.
Which is the thing that makes Venus's circular orbit seem so odd. And indeed the moon's. And also it does, that. I mean, that's a really cosmic point at which to have a break, I think, the idea that all of these particles, all of these electrons and protons in your body are actually, to a greater or lesser extent, attracted to every other single point in the cosmos.
Well, I think this is possibly actually a really good juncture to come back with a retelling of my electrobiology. I think we've done the micro and we're heading towards the macro, and we need to do the midi.
Yeah, absolutely. The
stuff,
brilliant.
All of us stuff in between.
Excellent, Jack. Well, we'll have a small break then, bit of a breath of fresh air and another glass of water or another bottle of Hobgoblin or whatever. And
directors here.
I'm going to
drink a London beer.
Go for it. I've got
go for that. Thames tap water. Love it.
Yeah, we're on tap water at the moment. I must admit, I miss the spring water, but we forgot to bring any with us. There you go.
I'm in central London, mate. Don't talk about spring water. That stuff comes out of plastic bottles.
Yeah. We've been collecting water, because round here there's plenty of people who've got boreholes and springs and things like that, and we tend to try.
Oh, put a bloody tune on. I want to go for a pee.
Okay, go for it. Here's here's Motorhead by Hawkwind, probably with Lemmy on bass.
You, star. That was exact. I wanted to hear this the other day. Well done.
I'll see you in 7 or 8 minutes, Jack.
I'll mute out.
You are, of course, listening to People's Internet Radio. .com. This is Dr. Rock's radio show, and in case any of you hadn't noticed, I'm talking to Freeman Jack. Here we go, Motorhead. Hot dog's moving in. Move it on over, physics. Jack's moving in. I know he's back with me. Let's kick off, Jack, with
we've got to pay our respects. Come on, George Thorogood and the Destroyers, man.
Absolutely.
Awesome.
I just love that slide guitar. The only thing is you can't have it loud.
I was so chuffed when you played that. I've heard that for years, mate. I used to have the album that come off of.
Absolutely. So every single track on that best of album is really, really kicking. In fact, I think they were two cracking tracks. I love that version of Motorhead from Hawkwind. Such a long time ago. I'm going to miss Motorhead, I must admit. I've seen them more often than anybody else. Met them several times, and they always struck me as being all right guys, you know?
I met Tank, Lemmy's chick, one time up in Camden, but never actually Lemmy.
I did actually meet Lemmy in a pub in London once by some strange coincidence. All the other times I'd found my way.
That's unusual. Why, how on earth did you find him there?
Yeah, indeed. God knows. Must have been a one-off, eh? And the thing is, he's so recognisable. You don't find
must
yourself thinking...
when he was out with boys, eh?
So,
too much content. What are you enjoying? I'm going to mute that. Hold on.
Okay, Vin's put in, no physicist can explain magnetism, which is a great statement. I've been watching a lot about magnetism through your links. What do you reckon?
I think that's possibly a bit of an exaggeration of the truth. No physicist outside of the Thunderbolts project can explain magnetism.
Yeah.
Again, we're talking about the electron dipole effect. That effectively, within a magnetic substrate, within a metal or within a mineral that has magnetic properties, what happens is that dipole is frozen in by the electrical properties internal to the structure of the material, which is why we only have a very sort of narrow range of materials that are known to be magnetic, is because it requires a certain number of fairly exotic electro properties of the actual atomic structure of the material itself. And what we're seeing there is effectively a frozen dipole, and a frozen atomic dipole, where the electrons will always orbit to one end. Which is why if you bash a magnet enough, it will stop working.
Yeah, but if you cut it in half, it'll still work exactly the same way it did before.
Precisely. Only you will have created a new north and south pole.
Yeah.
So, nearly the same.
And the magnetism and the charge separation are intimately linked.
And basically, magnetism is another effect, not a force. Electricity is the force. Magnetism is the effect that we see when electricity acts through certain minerals that have very particular dielectric properties.
Yeah.
Or for that matter, when electricity comes to a surface. So whenever we pass electricity through a wire, we experience magnetism at the surface of that wire.
So it's only when electricity comes to a surface that you see the magnetism. The magnetism's not always there wherever there's electricity?
As far as I know, there isn't a magnetic effect inside the wire. I think that the magnetic effect is only experienced outside the wire. So, yes, I believe that's true. I could be mistaken on that one. Don't quote me.
Okay, I won't.
I know most things. I don't know bloody everything. I may seem that way sometimes, but I really don't.
Okay, so when we stop...
Just to point out how little I actually do know, that in order to actually kind of brush up a bit on the show that I did with Vin, I was telling you earlier, I sat through nearly 50 hours of fresher course and first sort of season of the second year of an MIT physics degree course and an MIT electromagnetism degree course online in the weeks preceding that show, just so I could make sure that I had all my licks and chops in place.
Well, I must admit that listening to either you or Vin basically tends to remind me simply of how much I don't know, and it always sends me off looking to see if I can find out a bit more.
I keep sort of having this word genius banded around, and it really makes me feel very uncomfortable. And I keep often repeating that there's now, you know, I mean, the data is in, and essentially, in order to become what would be known as, say, a genius new grade musician, is simply a matter of practice. The reason why Mozart was simply because he got his 15,000 hours in before the age of six. So he was already virtuoso by the age of six.
Yes.
Well, when it comes to the sciences, I was effectively that virtuoso. I was reading Einstein age 11, not because anybody taught me, but just because that was where my fascination led me. And my wonderful sister, who was doing an education degree at Goldsmiths at the time, sort of recognised in me some of those talents and used to sort of feed me with books. So I'd get the sort of Jonathan Livingston Seagulls and the 1984s and the Animal Farms and the Catch 22s and the Catcher in the Rye and the Jonah and the Whale and Moby Dick, all that sort of stuff. So yeah, by the time I was sort of 14, I was pretty much read in all of the sort of classics. and, you know what I mean, had been given all sorts of weird and wonderful books simply because of my sort of love of reading all sorts. I mean, my main thing as a kid was sci-fi, but it wasn't the sort of space guns and sci-fi that most people like. It was the Asimov, it was the Foundation and Empire, it was the, in fact, funnily enough, that was all about crowd, studying behaviour of crowds.
They were brilliant.
The Foundation Empire series is all about a sociologist that works out that there's a mathematical algebra to the behaviour of humans.
Funnily enough,
goes on to be able to predict every human activity that he applies his maths to.
They were brilliant books, and I reread those last year, and there's a kind of, there seems to me to be quite a disturbing parallel between what Asimov was writing about, and he was a brilliant scientist as well, and what's actually going on now, because that is what they're trying to do.
Yeah, certainly the Bill Gates Foundation looks alarming like a foundation, doesn't it?
Yeah. And those books,
possibly even like Empire, which is even more alarming.
Yeah, anybody who hasn't read the Foundation, the original trilogy and the two books that came after it that he wrote in his later years, they are really well worth reading. And I've just finished reading I picked up a book from the library with all of his robot stories in it, and they were good.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Again, they meant one thing when I read them as a youngster, and it's completely different now. Reading
maybe
those things.
Maybe I should revisit his works. I must admit, it must be 4 decades since I last visited that man's works.
Bloody go back to the Foundation and Empire, definitely. I see also that he wrote a 2-volume commentary on the Bible, which I'd be quite interested to see.
Mm-hmm. So, just to kind of get us back onto track, really, the point being that there may not actually be any such thing as genius. And there's nothing particularly special about my understanding or knowledge here. I've just simply put in the hours. Yeah, I've done the work. So if I didn't understand something, it was never satisfactory to me to be in that condition of ignorance. And especially once I became aware that I didn't know something, that was even more incessant driving for me that I would have to go and find out what it was that I didn't know.
I think there has to be a capacity there, though, Jack, because really, when I was at school, I did really like the maths and I really enjoyed the physics, and I actually understood it when I was being taught it, but it was like a worm.
To be quite honest, for me, my particularly peculiar understanding, I think, really stems from my rather peculiar life of having this sort of dual life where my personal life is one of deep, you know what I mean, academic study, while my personal life tended to be more like digging a ditch.
Yeah.
So essentially I've been through, you know what I mean, heavy engineering and car mechanics and you know what I mean, fabrication and production line and agriculture and forestry and all of those industries and trades. And while I've been doing those industries and trades, I've been reading Asimov and Einstein and Newton and philosophers and studying various, you know, I mean, textbooks on various subjects. I mean, I'm effectively sort of a degree qualified steam technician from the amount of steam literature that I've read.
Yeah.
And not just literature about, oh, this train was wonderful. You know what I mean? It's like what the difference was with the valve system on that train that gave it 10% more power to the one that preceded it. They're the things of fascination to me.
Wouldn't it be fabulous if you actually had the resource to be able to make use of all this knowledge? I mean, you are.
Well, I actually have.
With your plant work, I think you're really getting there.
Well, no, I actually have. I now have possibly the financial resource. I have a millionaire couple who are effectively taking up a position as my backers. They may even be listening as we speak. And
we're not allowed to talk about that project.
There is a certain amount of corporate confidentiality about that particular subject, but I don't think there's any secrecy about the fact that I've picked up these two wonderful sponsors, and they appear to be really eager to put my ideas into production. And also to put them into production with my kind of optimal gradualism at the core of whatever company comes out of, you know what I mean, the ideas. So, yeah, I'm pretty keyed up with the events that are coming my way in the new year and hopefully the rest of the planet, because it's certainly not mine.
It strikes me that you're gardening.
You know my philosophy on ownership, you know what I mean? And that's one of the things that they're finding it a little bit difficult to kind of contain, is because I want to tell the world and I've got to keep it shtum, which is killing me.
Well, that's good practice. It does strike me that your gardening techniques are reaching into your optimal gradualism theory as well. What you're discovering is that that system works through optimal gradualism, that radical action doesn't work as well.
And specifically, that was actually how we deployed it, because initially we were working in a hideous chemical bloody hydroponic system for some guy who'd done biochemistry at uni or something and thought that he was the bee's knees on plant chemistry. And knew all the ins and outs, knew all the various chemicals, all the various chemistry, what was going on here, what was going on there. And it was hideous. It was horrible. The crop was nasty. The plants were nasty. It had disease, it had bugs. Everything was wrong that could possibly be wrong. And we tried to convert him to growing organic initially. And his resistance was what basically forced me to go and dig out the science. I had to take him the science.
Yeah.
And when I went to the science books, I found there wasn't any. When I went to the permaculture movement, it was another foundationless theory.
Yeah, I was interested in your interaction with permaculture and whether you actually learnt anything from the experts you came across there.
Oh, you must be joking. I sat in the audience of a panel, and the most basic of questions, oh, God, I knew three times as much as any of their answers and came away very, very much wanting.
Which I think is a shame, because permaculture itself, the actual essence of the thing, is a really good idea. It's just like so many other things, the direction it goes in isn't always the direction you'd expect it to go in.
Well, it seems to me that the permaculture movement tends to largely make most of its kind of public presence felt through things like companion planting and green mulching and things like this, but there's no real... Again, there's no substance to the theory. This is all supposition. And, well, it's not quite supposition. In the case of the permaculture movement, as with all agriculture, essentially you're talking about an experiential science. So you're talking about, we did this last year, it got better, it got worse. We did this next year, it got better, it got worse.
But nobody's actually
measuring. Yeah, and then you just stack. Basically the science of agricultural science is essentially the stacking of sort of 500 years of human agriculture on top of each other, and assuming that somehow you now know how agriculture works.
Except that they don't necessarily look for the reasons behind it.
Absolutely not, because I would suggest that agrochemical monoculture is effectively replicating a naturally existing biological battery that powers plants from its inherent processes that are native to the soils, and it basically drowns out that effect in the soils and simply pours on an electrolyte. So it's a bit like taking a biological battery and replacing it with a lead-acid car battery. Yeah, they both push voltage, but one's an awful lot more harmful than the other.
Well, you're the first person I've heard talking about electricity or electric potential and plants.
Well, I am the first person. I mean, I can point you to various textbooks of people that have sort of fringed around the surface. I've got a book from the 1890s of the study of abnormal behaviour of plants in the polar circle. And certainly they are pointing to an electromagnetic cause to the erroneous plant behaviour in that particular latitude. But they don't actually draw any conclusions from that. It's actually just a research book. They went up there, they looked, they took the data. They might draw a few conclusions from it, but there's no further pursuance on that. And like I say in my initial electrobiology theory paper, that I suspect that it may well have been Voltaire's demonstrations at the National Institute of the Jumping Frog's Legs when electricity was first postulated. And in that theatre at the time, in fact, I've subsequently found it wasn't actually Voltaire's lecture. It was Faraday's subsequent lecture demonstrating much of what Voltaire was presenting in his earlier lecture to a later audience. And apparently in that later audience, we have the likes of Franz Mesmer, who went on to generate mesmerism, which we now know as hypnotism. Who is also famous for a subject called animal magnetism, where he suggested that all animals had a magnetic nature. And we also have in the back of the room Mary Shelley, who we know went on to create Frankenstein.
And do you think that's why established science is steering so clear of electricity?
What do we call fringe biology to this day?
Yeah.
We call it Frankenstein science.
Mm.
Yeah? So I honestly think that scientists have been scared away by that moniker of Frankenstein science. If you're looking at electricity and biology, you're a Frankenstein character. And the thing that you're creating will be the Frankenstein's monster. And so nobody goes near it. And moreover, like I was pointing out to you today, the fact that you've got a digital voltmeter makes this available to you, because one of the things that I did find was that from my voltage readings using the IAR, the voltage amps watts calculation, I was able to take the resistance across my circuit, the voltage across my circuit, and calculate the amperage. And the amperage that we're talking about in these biological systems is like tens of a millionth of an amp. It's microscopic. And the thing is that the old avometers, the needle voltmeters that would be available up until, you know what I mean, the sort of 1980s when digital voltmeters first started becoming available, the amount of current that is required to drive against the needle, against the spring of those meters, is 10,000 times greater than the current that I'm registering for my plants. So the actual fact of the matter is that nobody up until the advent of the digital voltmeter would have ever even been able to read these voltages.
And it doesn't
because
seem to.
The instrument, and moreover, the observation problem again is entering into this, that you can't carry out protracted measurements even at this scale, because the instrument that you're measuring it with affects the field of the plant and you begin to kill the plant. So I left one plant connected up to a voltmeter for a single day, and by the end of that 24-hour period, its internal voltage had almost vanished.
So you have a bit of the uncertainty principle here.
No, I think it's simply that the instrument is conducting some of the current that the plant would normally be using for its internal processes. Yeah. So it's simply that the instrument is drawing current from a circuit with such tiny current that even though the current it is drawing is microscopic, it's still significant at those scales.
Well, that's surely
so essentially the actual thing that you're observing the thing with is basically sucking the energy that the plant derives its biology from, and it won't live for very long without that source of electricity.
Which is probably one of the best demonstrations of the validity of your theories that you've had, I would have thought.
And this is the thing that's really been driving me insane, is that I never expected this to be such a powerful predictive model. And that was always my initial premise with this, was that I was going to pursue it as long as the theory was able to be applied in practice as a predictive model. And every single prediction that I've made, even to the point where when I went public on that show with Vin the other week, there were actually elements to the theory that I presented that were at that time still utterly tentative and were purely derived from the model itself. They weren't derived from any observations that I'd made at that time. I subsequently found a video on YouTube that absolutely proves, without any reasonable doubt in my mind, that my model that I gave on that Sunday wasn't an absolute description of what is happening. And I was able to make that description by understanding the way that biology is deriving its nature through the separation of charge and by utilizing the negativeness of the sky and the positiveness of the ground as like an electric elastic band to drive all of its functions. And like I say, the model is becoming incredibly predictive. So whether or not it's an actual description of what biology is doing, as far as an effective bloody map, it's a ton better than anything in the biology textbooks currently. I mean, just to go there, you know what I mean? I was saying off air about how I was slightly troubled that I'd forgotten entirely about my McDonald's milkshake analogy in explaining why biology is so corrupted currently. And essentially, in the biological model that we have at the moment, that all plants gain their water through two effects. One is called the wicking effect, and that's where if you dip a piece of cloth into a bowl of water, the water will soak up and basically defy gravity and rise up the cloth. You can use wicks to water plants from a saucer of water and things like this.
Yeah.
And another thing is the osmosis effect, which is where if you have a semi-permeable boundary, which is the holes in it are too small to allow, say, a saltwater molecule to pass through, but are small enough to allow a pure water molecule to pass through, then the pure water will transfer from the pure side to the salt side. And this is the process that we know as osmosis. And basically all plant biology, every single thing that you see from the tiniest of little algae to the giant redwoods is supposed to somehow be explained. All of the water transport, all of the cell transport, all of the organisation, everything to do with plant biology is either the wicking effect, the capillary effect, or the osmosis effect. And that's it. And the easiest way that I can find to debunk this is when you actually look under a microscope at soil, there is no free water. All of the water in any given soil, I don't care how wet it is bound up around particles of soil and forming little spheres. So this means that no, unless the plant's actually standing in water, there's no actual part of the root that is in direct contact with a single piece of water. So what we're effectively saying is that somehow the plants are able to get a McDonald's milkshake, and by poking the straw just through the top of the plastic lid and not into the surface of the milkshake at all, are somehow able to extract an entire milkshake from the carton. It's a physical impossibility.
Yeah.
So for me, I had to find some way of describing the way that the soil moved from the soil medium into the plant roots without using the bloody McDonald's straw floating above the surface of the milkshake or any other brand of...
So how does it?
Nasty. Well, this is the point. So let's go there. This is electrobiology in a nutshell. That essentially, the soil medium, although the surface of the earth is broadly positively charged, it has a positive potential, the actual soil mediums themselves, the particles, are broadly speaking neutrally charged, and this is why soil pH is always around 7.2. Basically, what we know as pH, so acidity or alkalinity, is either an excess of electrons or a deficit of electrons. Okay, and pH neutral is no electrical activity at all, so neutrally electrical. Now, the other thing about soil, especially the better soils, is that they're largely made up either of quartz or silica minerals, and that these quartz and silica minerals present A, an enormous surface area, but B, also an incredibly electrocapacitant, neutrally electrical surface area, which will catch hold of positively ionized water molecules, i.e. slightly acidic water molecules, carrying a slightly positive charge. And these will be bound to these soil particles. They'll be electrically bound to them. But they'll only be bound to them very weakly because they're not being bound to a negative charge. So they're not being stuck like two magnets, two, you know what I mean, north and south of a magnet together. They're being kind of bound more like... what are they bloody called? Those are post-it notes. Yeah? So it's not like an Evo stick. It's like a post-it note. It's stuck, but it's not stuck very firmly. A slight pull will get rid of it.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay? Now, essentially, the root on the plant is like the sheath on the wires in your mains. It's an insulator. It's an electrical insulator. And we can consider the fluid inside the vesicles within the root itself as carrying quite a strong negative charge. They'll be quite alkaline. Now, at the surface of the roots, we have the pores. Now, because the pores of the roots are on the outside of a sort of an elastic pipe, that when that pipe shrinks, the pore opens. When the pipe expands, the pore closes. You see, so the pores in the root surface are literally self-regulating according to the level of hydration of the plant. So if the plant begins to dehydrate, the pores naturally open, and if the plant's well hydrated, then the pores will naturally close as the pipe swells and closes up the aperture. Now, because the pipe is effectively an insulator and the electrical activity is inside, when the pore opens, what it does is it presents a little localized hotspot of highly negative electrical potential. And these weakly attached, positively charged water molecules within the soil medium will be inexorably pulled towards it. And you can imagine the pore being like the end of a bar magnet under a piece of paper that you sprinkled iron filings on. Yeah? Where the lines of force will be greatest nearest to the pore, but they will extend out from the into the medium.
So the plant's roots could be drawing water from quite a distance away.
From an infinite distance, because it's subject to the inverse square law, that it will be drawing water from as far as it can influence on an exponential decreasing curve.
Exactly the same as you were describing before the break to do with our atoms in charge. Yeah.
Precisely. This is how charge acts. So charge separation acts through the inverse square law, where for every one unit of distance gained, you have a 4 times increase in area of action and a 4 times decrease in the power of action.
You see, that's absolutely brilliant, because I often wondered how, when plants get thirsty, which, you know, when they're growing as youngsters, they put on
like
some
a dry tree seeking water,
incredible amount of mass. And I was figuring that if the roots were only getting water from the thing they were in contact with, they were going to end up with dry roots pretty quickly, and that's a really good way of killing a plant.
And this is essentially where the hyphae, where the mycorrhizomal hyphae come into this. So the symbiotic fungi, I mean, when you look at a root system, it's actually only the thick, fibrous, white roots in the middle that are actually the plant. All that fuzzy stuff around the outside that most people think are root plant roots are actually mycorrhizomal fungi that have basically wiggled their heads in between the plates of the roots system and embedded themselves in one of the root cells and is feeding sugars from the plant, which the plant quite happily gives it. In fact, the plant will send sugars down once it detects the presence of a fungal head. Now, how does the plant know to send sugars south and ionic water north? Well, it doesn't. It's because the charge that the head of that hyphae carries is strong enough that it will draw the negatively charged sugars towards that hyphal head. And in return, the hyphae is connecting the plant to something like a million times more surface area than the roots could ever contact in a million years. And moreover, the hyphae grow at such an incredible rate. I mean, literally, I've been watching stop frame animations, and mycorrhizomal hyphae look like bloody lightning storms in these things. They are that fast. Admittedly, they're like our stop frame, so, you know, I mean, it's 1 hour from one image to the next. But I'm seeing things occurring within those stop frame animations that just look completely unbiological. The speed that they happen at, it looks more animal than...
And where do they come from, these mycorrhizal fungi? In a pot, you know? You've got a pot.
Well, it's in...
Because they're specific
they're
to
everywhere.
Plants as
the
well,
spores,
aren't they?
The spores of mycorrhizal fungi are in every single mass of dust that you've ever seen in your life. Will have been billions of them. Certainly if you go to like a woodlands, all of the dirt, all of the dust that you see blowing around by the sides, a vast majority of that will be fungal spores. And every time that you see a wood pile with a big fungus poking out, a big mushroom poking out the top of it, well, that entire wood pile is in fact the mycelium, the fungal hyphae that are the actual mushroom, and what you're seeing there, what we call a mushroom, is in fact only the fruiting head of that mycelial mass. And the mycelial mass will literally be occupying every inch, literally every square inch of that wood pile.
And it will only express itself in the soil with or without the presence of
Well, no, they actually respond to their symbiotic partners.
Okay, right. They need the food.
So the specific... fungal hyphae will seek out their selective symbiotes. So specific species like particular symbiotic relationships with specific mycorrhizomal fungi, and somehow the two manage to find each other.
And how many of these mycorrhizal fungi are there? I mean, are we talking about a dozen, or are they specific to individual
plants?
There's
about 5 kilometres in a cubic centimetre of soil.
Mm-hmm. But are they specific? I mean, I gathered that, like, the example of a wood, I'm told that trees of a given sort within a wood will all be connected by a specific sort of mycorrhizal fungi, which is doing exactly what you're describing.
The forest floor in those woods, as you correctly say, each species will have its own hyphal mat and the entire forest floor will be made up of that mat. And that those trees are not only in communication with all of the soil and all of the water in the soil, but it now appears that they communicate quite literally, electrically, through that network. And if there's a dying fellow, if there's an ailing fellow amongst their group, the trees are known to donate their sugars to the one that's ailing. Now, again, I would suggest that that's an electrical property.
Blimey.
That the one that's dying is having problems with its electrical circuit, so the other plants suddenly find on their network a negative draw, where before there was an excess of positivity, so their food is inexorably drawn towards their ailing cousin.
So a wood will contain lots of different sorts of this fungi to cover all
and
the
all
plants.
Growing and dying at an incredible rate as well. The normal hyphae only lasts about 4 days and then it begins to go green and die back, and a new one will replace it. So this is another thing as well. These are exploratory creatures. They literally explore every inch of the soil medium and overtake it. And because they've got a growing tip that connects with these positively charged ionized waters, that effectively makes each one of those hyphae a one-way electrical circuit, always pointing towards the plant, which is another thing that I mentioned to you off-air, wasn't it? Was that in the chat, was that every time I measure a voltage in my system, that I can take that reading from the plant to anywhere in the soil, and it will always be the same direction voltage. It will always be from the soil towards the plant, according to the rules of my electrobiology, according to the canopy being positively charged and the soil, the roots being negatively charged.
Brilliant. Brilliant.
So effectively what we're seeing is we're seeing a sort of a protozoal and amoebal soup within the soil medium. What we think of as soil isn't actually soil. It's small particles of soil that are surrounded by protozoa, which are all feeding on it. Those protozoa exude a kind of jelly snot that is the binding agent that actually sticks soil together, that turns soil from dust into soil. So every single piece of soil that you've ever seen in your life wasn't actually soil. It was a tiny little particle of dust surrounded by 100 or 1,000 protozoa in various stages of either life or death. Now, the protozoa, I would suggest, in their billions, provide a tiny electrical charge, which will also have its mechanism in regulating the water pH of any water that comes into contact with them. Okay, so if they make their environment slightly acidic, then any water that passes through that environment will pick up that ionization and will become acidic too. So essentially, these are like little electrolyte generators and generate the electrolyte for the soil. The hyphae come along looking for water and plug into that now positively ionized electrolyte. And because they've got one end in a positive circuit, that means that the other end has got to be negative. It's got no choice. So the positive ions will inexorably move their way along the strand of the hyphae, up the pipe of the hyphae, and be delivered into the core of the root, right where it's needed, into the root cell itself, where a charge of positively ionized water will now be delivered into a water circuit that is connected to the positively charged canopy, but is in a negative charge state. So the positively ionized water is literally given an electric shunt up to the canopy. And it's not until it breaches the soil that it's then taken over by sort of flow and evaporation and things like that begin to kick in and have a minor effect. But the major effect in sap transport and in water acquisition is an electrostatic effect.
God, it's incredible, isn't it? It's
okay, and so we'll kind of get past this, and so we've done the root system now. Above the ground, things start to change slightly. Above the ground, we're now looking at, first of all, the shapes of the roots. The tap root will always go down almost perpendicular. And the reason for this is it's given like a little charge of sort of lodestones, or like little heavy bob weights in the tip. And this effectively acts like a pendulum pointing the way down. And so roots will always grow inexorably, broadly speaking, straight down, or at least the tap root will. Now, the reason why the side roots branch off at the angles that they do is, again, charge separation. That because the growing tips of the roots carry a negative charge exactly the same as the growing tap root, those charges repel. And they repel at very specific angles. So the actual shape, the actual pattern that we see the roots taking as they migrate through the soil is dictated by charge separation, and they will always maintain a correct charge separation with their negatively charged neighbour simply according to the rules of Faraday's and Maxwell's and Gauss.
Right, so it's doing both jobs at once. It's attracting what it needs and it's maintaining space for itself through the same...
Yeah. And now, so we get above the soil, and now effectively what we have, let's take it from germination of the seed. So on germination of the seed, the growing tip doesn't do a damn thing. It just sits there in the seed, all folded up. The root starts a bid for downwards because it's got the lodestone and it knows which way is down. I suggest that the initial wetting of the seed is like a transistor switch event where on a transistor you switch the major load with a small signal wire, where you simply place a little bit of extra current into the silicon wafer and that allows it to transmit the large current across the two big terminals. And I suspect that this is the sort of thing that's happening in biology, where we're seeing these large switching events that appear to take place all of a sudden, all at once, and from no apparent source, like seed germination. So I suspect that what's happening with seed germination, and certainly this lima bean video, is convincing to my eyes, and I even convinced my one of my twins that electrobiology is real, where they'd all been unconvinced prior to this. He's come and he's looked at it, he's heard my explanation, he's gone, nope, you're right, electrobiology is right, well done, pissed off again. But essentially what we're seeing with the seed is we have a dry seed which will carry a particular electrical charge, probably a slightly positive electrical charge, in its dry state, or positive or neutrally electrically charged. We now place that into an electrical soil medium, which is just inherently electrical. It doesn't matter whether it's in a pot or in the soil. It's just the nature of soil. It is an electrical medium. Now, if we add water to that soil medium and there's protozoa in it, that water is going to become positively ionized, as through the mechanism that we said before, or it may become positively ionized through nitrate salts and things like this that are in the soil that add a positive charge. All of the nutrients that the agrochemicals duplicate with their nasty battery acid stuff that they do are effectively very positively charged minerals. So everything that we think of as plant food is just simply carrying a very heavy positive charge. For whatever else it does, that's its primary thing, is to add positive charge to the water.
Do they know that? The people that are making these things know that, do you think?
No, of course not.
They just think it's nutrients.
No, they're oblivious. I mean, essentially, somebody was actually asking me why hasn't anybody thought of this before. Well, the reason why nobody's thought of this before is in order to be able to actually come up with the electrobiology theory, I not only had to have a really solid grounding in basic biology, but I also needed a grounding in physics, high-energy electrical discharge, in things like coronal discharge, in electronics. I mean, how many biologists get taught this at university?
Well, that's the whole point of the specialisation. That's the whole point of the specialisation.
It's purely my extraordinary dualistic life of digging a ditch while thinking about, you know what I mean, platonic geometry that has led me to this point. And so I'm in this extraordinary position of having achieved this kind of internal realization of what's going on in the systems that I'm actually running in real world. I mean, this is the other thing as well, is this is all real world derived. I didn't have the theory first and then I was actually basically doing the stuff and having to explain it to somebody else why it was working. And when I went to the textbooks, there was no bloody explanation. We were replacing all fertilizers with worm castings in water. Oh, shit, this is great, you know what I mean? We've cracked this, you know what I mean? There we go, there's something we can show. You know, I mean, plants are growing healthily, there's no nitrate, no, just worm castings. You know what I mean? There you go, biology fixed it. And I went to the textbooks and went to look at the nitrogen, potassium and whatever it is in worm castings, and it's like trace or like negligible. Tubby, stop bloody scratching. Flea bag.
So your worm castings have got I mean, I know the worm food that comes out of wormeries, the liquid, is actually really powerful food, isn't it? Or is that just another electrical element? I mean, do your plants get any? Do you get any food at all?
Worm castings is all we use for food, and we're now brewing compost teas with worm castings as well, which are just simply a way of taking what's already there and multiplying it very quickly.
But have you tested the sort of worm tea for nutrients?
I haven't, but as far as I know, again, it's according to the agrochemical model, it would be trace, it would be negligible. All right, so essentially I was feeding the plants with something that wasn't plant food, and it was doing all of the things that plant food was doing. And so I was basically presented with a conundrum. I somehow had to explain to this very scientific boss how this miracle was somehow happening. And that was really where I began to sort of ferment the electrobiology theory, was because I began to realize that the actual thing that the worm castings were doing was creating sort of nucleation sites, the action of the worm guts and the biology and the bacteria in there were effectively on such nano scales by the time they came out as a worm casting that you're effectively using a biological nano product as a plant food. And that because of each of these little nucleation sites and because of the dipole of water, basically because of the two hydrogen atoms and the one oxygen carrying opposite charges, and that water doesn't form a sort of straight line between the hydrogen and the oxygen, it forms a sort of little triangle, a little delta. It means every water molecule is slightly more positively charged at one end than at the other. And so all of these like sort of little nano nucleation sites, all with their own little electrical property, be that neutral, acidic, base, whatever, are all going to have their organizing effect, their structuring effect on the actual substance of the water. And I began to realize that this worm castings were actually affecting the electrical properties of the water directly, but locally, so that if you actually tested the water, it still came up as pH neutral after you've added the worm castings.
So, I mean, I can't say I blame your boss for having a bit of difficulty with this, because, you know, what we're taught as plantsmen and stuff is that it is all down to nitrogen, potassium and potash in different quantities. And you are providing those in trace amounts, but otherwise the things... Mind you, yeah, again, of course, photosynthesis, it makes a lot of its own food. Sorry, I'm thinking on the hoof now. That's the thing. It's making a lot of its own food from light. That's how it develops sugars, isn't it? So it's food.
And it is getting food,
even though you're not giving it to it.
I would suggest, although I don't know, and this is another one a bit like the seed issue with Vin on Sunday, I would suggest that the sugars probably carry a negative charge once they're generated, which is why they head down towards the roots. And it's not that the plant's making sugars and going, oh, I need to send those to my roots now. It's just simply that the sugars carry a negative charge, the canopy's positively charged, the canopy will pump the sugars down to the roots.
But nonetheless, what I'm saying is that even though you successfully seem to be showing that your old NPK's not relevant and that there's no food in the worm casting, it's not that the plant is getting no food, it's manufacturing its own as a result of these processes.
No, specifically it is getting food, but it's the food that it's getting won't read as either NPKs or acidity or alkalinity. It's pH neutral, but it's pH neutral because it's a bit like how can I put it? Again, I have to go down to this nano scale. When we're talking about the microscopic scale, water just simply has nothing like the properties that we're expecting. And because we're talking about these mycorrhizomal hyphae being down on the 10 nanometer to 100 nanometer scale, these are microscopic things. We can see them with the naked eye, but only because there's tens of millions of them. You know what I mean? You'll see the white hyphal mat and you'll go, oh, look, there's mycorrhizomal. It's not till you put them under the microscope that you see what that bloody mycorrhizomal looks like. So essentially with the biological system, the electrical charges are induced without the need for nitrogen, potassium, etc. However, the biological action of the amoebas, the protozoa, and the higher order animals that then feed on those is to actually to harvest minerals, micronutrients, and macronutrients, and basically focus them into a nematode turd or a tick turd. Yeah, so basically the macroorganisms go around hoovering up the protozoa soup and hoovering up algae and hoovering up the amoeba as fast as they can and crapping them out of their back end, having condensed like a million protozoa into a single little poop.
Brilliant. So all of those little critters that you're finding with your USB microscope are providing a kind of food.
Our food. And so they're not only are they the battery that powers the electricity that the plant is. I mean, again, this is the water transport side of it. But there's also this effect of we're going to have to go to ball discharge here, I think. Essentially, what we're talking about here is something called cold plasma. And we're looking at an effect that's known as coronal discharge. Now, we know of coronal discharge events from the main transmission circuit. On rainy days, you'll sometimes see like bolts of lightning going between the big electric transmission circuits.
Yeah.
And this is basically the sort of evidence of this coronal discharge. And this essentially what happens is at the surface of a capacitant sphere. We'll keep using spheres just simply because they're a nice simple object to consider, since we live on the surface of one and we live under the surface of one, spinning around the surface of another one, is that when the electrical capacity of that particular sphere of ball capacitance of R1 is met, its charge separation from its next sphere of influence, the next sphere of ball capacitance out from its sphere, has a particular spark gap, at which point the electricity from the one sphere can jump that north-south divide between the two. So, effectively, coronal discharge, we see it when it goes to glow mode, but it's actually in exactly the same form, like almost like a standing wave, like a bloody hedgehog, sticking out from the surface of the ball capacitor with little spikes of charge in all directions. And they're completely invisible to us. They're just little ionized streams of air where the electricity is changing the electrical properties of the air and the surrounding atoms and making them more sort of electrically organized. And what will happen is that small amounts of current will begin to move along these pathways. If that pathway doesn't connect with an opposite charge, then we don't see the lightning. We don't see that big flash of blue spark between the power lines. But it doesn't mean that coronal discharge. Exactly. Yeah. And essentially, the surface of the Earth and the sky, the spark gap is around 10 megavolts. Okay, so this means that the electrical potential difference between the positiveness of the ground and the negativeness of the inside of the upper atmosphere is 10 megavolts. Now, what happens is when a charged cloud comes along underneath that, so first of all, it's reducing the distance, so it's now got a lower radius, a smaller r, yeah, which again is going to decrease the size of the spark gap and decrease the amount of the voltage needed to jump that gap. And because the cloud is also a charge-separated thing, with the bottom of the cloud being negatively charged and the top of the cloud being positively charged, it actually drags the sphere of the atmosphere, because it's not a fixed hard sphere, because it's a gas. It dimples it locally around that cloud. And so what happens is that this focuses the naturally existing 10 megavolts of potential in the atmosphere into that cloud. The cloud goes over voltage. It breaches the spark gap voltage potential needed. And now suddenly the coronal discharge that was there all along now meets, say, one positive leader or meet a negative leader, and now we've got a negative and a positive connected together. Electricity travels through the both. It ionizes the air into a plasma, so it basically vaporizes the atoms of the air, knocking them into their component constituents. And in this condition, the plasma is actually a conductor of electricity. And so the lightning bolt that we see... Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah, so the lightning bolt that we see is, in fact, traveling that path because it's actually following the ionizing of the air that was created by the initial charge. Now, if we extract this to biology, every single plant, as it emerges from the ground, has a positively charged tip because of charge separation, because the liquids inside are charge separating. The positive ones are going up, the negative ones are going down. And this positively charged tip is being literally dragged up out of the soil by that 10 megavolt potential up in the atmosphere.
Whoa.
It's sucking the plant out of the ground. But this suck is actually quite weak because it's a long way away. Yeah, exponential, square, curve, inverse square law, 4 times weaker for 1 times distance. Yeah. So although it's an incredibly high potential, the actual amount of suck that it's pulling down at the plant level is fairly minimal. And so what we see is almost every seedling will get to exactly the same height and it will stop on its first like branch, on its first stem, on its tip coming up. And it will stop at that point. And at that point, it can't grow any further. The reason why it can't grow any further is because the charge separation between the negativeness of its root tip and the positiveness of its green tip have now effectively reached the maximum of that little elastic band. The pull from the sky isn't greater now than the pull from the negativeness of the root on the positiveness of the tip. So that little plant has now become like a little strung, like tightly pulled elastic band. Now, there's no way for that plant to carry on growing up. But because of the laws of electrostatics, a charge separated is a charge halved. So what does the plant do?
Its
first two leaves.
Yeah, bifurcates.
It bifurcates. And what happens with the bifurcation? You've now taken that charge that had reached its end at the elastic of its elastic band at that point, and you've now divided it by two. So your one elastic band becomes two smaller elastic bands. Now, these elastic bands have got their own charge separation distance, and that charge separation distance is a product of the difference between the R1 of the tip and the R2 of the new tip of the leaves. And the mathematical interrelationship of these two things is the computation of the surface of a sphere, which is pi r cubed. So essentially, for every one increment of radius from the bifurcation point, we have an r cubed, a pi r cubed increase in surface area. And that pi r cubed increase in surface area allows for a much larger capacitant dissipation. So the same charge that stopped the plant dead at R1 will now allow the plant to grow to R1 over phi.
R1 over phi, eh?
Mm. And the reason for this is because of the charge distribution. We're still talking about the same amount of charge. So the difference between the charge distribution on R1 and the charge distribution on R2 is a relationship in radius of R to phi.
Quite, yep.
You see me?
Yep. And it can keep doing
and then,
that.
And then we can carry that on up into the canopy. So as the canopy begins to grow, and again, the reason why the leaves adopt the separation that they do is because they're both positively charged and they're both equally repelling. So they try and find the point furthest away from each other.
So what is it that eventually stops? Because obviously all plants have got, you know, different heights, haven't they?
They appear to have a specific height, and I would suggest that their specific height... I think the reason why I've studied what are known as type 2 annuals, like tomato plants, pepper plants, and some others that we know that I've studied quite closely... is because they're annuals, because they're predictable, because they have a very predictable life cycle, and because their morphology is almost identical. Okay, so the reason why I've taken that specific type of plant and selected it as my speciality is for that specific reason. Now, I suspect that's what's going on with annuals is slightly different to, say, a tree or a herbaceous perennial or a biennial, etc. Okay, so the model that I'm giving here purely applies to the sort of everyday annual plant that you grow from seed in the spring, it grows to fruition, and it dies at the end of the season. Okay, now the reason why I've picked on that is because it's the map. Yeah, it's the simplification. It's the best simplification that I could find of all the complexity of biology.
Okay.
Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm presenting a map using the type 2 annual as a predictive model. And if we apply the rationale with which we've understood the type 2 annual with, we can possibly understand the greater and greater complexities of things like deciduous hardwoods and pine trees. And I honestly think that I can now explain all of those by mapping from predictively from this type 2 model.
Well, that's quite exciting, because that's going to be more new news, isn't it? Why? Because there's other plants that really love to just creep along the ground, and you know, there's plants that, as they grow, the kind of younger leaves are somehow left behind and die off, leaving them. I've been looking at the trees.
I can actually explain that, because I was very carefully watching some cuttings that I'd taken. And I was fascinated, because these cuttings had actually got quite old. We'd kind of held them back for a while because we weren't quite ready for them. So as cuttings go, they were pretty old, and we kept them in little tiny 2-inch pots to keep them back. So they'd only just gone into their full-size pots. And I was watching these things as they were kind of like bushying out as their initial stages, sort of pushing out sort of new mature leaves from the sort of sides of the leaf sites that already existed on the cutting. And they seem to sit in this sort of phase for a week or so, where they sort of clumped and turned into like a little mushroom of growth. And I'm watching the leaves of the cuttings, which would have been the last mature leaves of the plant that they were taken as cuttings from. And these leaves were staying in absolutely perfect condition, prime condition. They were showing no signs of aging, no signs of necrosis. They were in really rude health. And I was quite surprised by this, because they do normally die back, and I've noticed them dying back in the past.
They do.
So I'm watching these buggers real fucking careful, because I knew it was important. Excuse my French. And blow me if, when the growing tip didn't start out of this little sort of clumpy mushroom thing that the cutting took initially, the second that growing tip went up, basically I'd open the cupboard door in the morning and see the plants that the tip had now sprouted overnight from, and those bloody leaves would be stone dead.
Dead quick.
Overnight. It was like a switch had been switched. Sorry.
So they were there, doing a job, but once the thing had started growing, they were no longer needed.
Switch.
Yeah, and also you're cutting.
And hold on, I can explain, yeah. and this is really illustrative, is that what happens is that the growing tip carries like a little toroid, a little donut of energy, a little donut of positiveness, and it lifts it up away from the pot. And the root has its own little donut of energy, of negative energy, beneath the soil. And as the growing tip raises its donut up from the soil and the two separate, that one leaf site now goes from being in the influence of the upward sap generating positiveness of the canopy into the sugar draining negativeness of the root. And so literally overnight, the same sap that had been keeping it well profused and green and all that the day before had now not only drained out of it, but had sucked all the sugars out of it as well, making it go yellow and basically die overnight.
Yeah.
I mean, normal leaf necrosis takes a week or more.
Yeah.
So this is a really rapid event. You know,
that's really interesting. Yeah, because
moreover, it only ever happened to those one leaf. Those same plants are now growing. They're nearly 2 months older.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only leaf that's ever died on those plants.
And there's another trick thing there, isn't there? Because, I mean, we've described the seed with its roots that's got a kind of plumb bob on it or whatever. But when you put a cutting into soil, it's got to grow roots. It's got to grow roots from the bottom of the plant.
Well, it actually goes about sideways from the stem.
Right. So,
but they come out horizontally and then head straight down.
Okay, and that also is a charge determined activity, is it?
Yeah, well, essentially they'll be following the sort of the capacitance, the ball capacitance, the coronal discharge of the negativeness of the bottom of the stem. And that will be basically pointing out in all directions, but then once they've broken out in whatever direction they find out, once they're out, they're then subject to gravity and these little plumb bob weights in the tips. Mm-hmm. And so inexorably move downwards, but then as they're moving downwards and come next to their peers are equally negatively charged and repel them. So they take their nice little 30-degree detours around each other.
So we're saying that it's not just the kind of charge in the atmosphere that these things are reaching for, that they're actually carrying charge with them, generating it round themselves.
And not only that, but I suspect that the actual spraying of the sap water from the leaf pores, if it is still carrying any of that positively ionized water when it gets sprayed as a microdroplet spray out from the leaf pores, then it's actually going to be directly varying the electrical properties and especially the coronal discharge in its local field effect. And so what we appear to be seeing is that the height of a plant will be determined by a relationship, an interrelationship between its availability of food, the availability of water, the amount of biology in the soil that is then electrically charging that water, how much of that water it can then transport up into the air and spray out to change the electrical properties of the air around it, which will be increasing its capacity for growth, which is why rainforests are so goddamn verdant, because they're actually generating their own electrical field event.
So even the transpiration's part of this process?
Well, if you can imagine the electrically ionised field that would exist around a well-perfused tree in, say, midsummer, yeah, the coronal discharge around that, if you can imagine your little plasma ball thing with the glowing ball in the middle and you put your hand on it and all the lightning comes to it, that's your tree. That's a corona discharge.
Even looks like lightning.
Precisely, and if you follow each of those links in the electrobiology paperwork there, you will find some very key links to things like coronal discharge through perspex. And many of these things just look like bloody trees.
It's always, it's not just trees. You look at kind of schematics of the way brains grow. They look the same as trees as well. You know,
and
not just the brain.
I would suggest that the reason why the brain is in the top of the body and various other bits of our body are in the lower portion will be down to their negativeness or positiveness. That again, if the electrobiology model maps biology as accurately as it should, there should be no reason why we shouldn't be able to look at every single part of animal biology and map it on from the same.
Well, that was going to be one of my questions. Is do you know we've heard a lot about earthing, walking barefoot on the earth. Of course, we mostly don't walk on the earth, and when we do, we mostly walk with insulated shoes on, or shoes that insulate us nowadays. Is it possible
voltages that we're talking about here wouldn't actually be in the slightest bit troubled by the soles of the shoes on the soles of your feet. They'll just travel through your body regardless. Every time you're standing up, if you're 6 foot tall, there is a 360-volt potential difference between the soles of your feet and the top of your head at all times.
But are you drawing, is that in your body, or are you drawing that from the earth?
You're not actually drawing it from anywhere. It's just simply the charge separation of your feet being 6 feet below your head and the 10 megavolts. When you divide the 10 megavolts into meter sections, it's 160 volts a meter. Hence 320 volts per 6 foot.
Mm-hmm.
To reach the 10 megavolts when you get up to 5 kilometers. And I actually calculated the potential difference between the crown of a giant redwood and its soil level, and it's about 97,000 volts. So a giant redwood has a voltage gradient, which runs uphill from the soil up to the tip of the root. So basically there's an electrical gradient that works anti-gravity up the tree. and it's powered by 97,000 volts. So my paltry little 200 millivolt cell reading in my plant. So. But again, you're not actually going to be able to test this. There's no way of... Again, you've got this measurement problem with electricity. Is the only way of measuring electricity is as either part of the circuit or as an... what do they call it? Induced circuit. So basically by running a circuit next to it that somehow picks up on the activity of the one next to it through electromagnetism.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the problem with this circuit is it's such tiny currents, there's almost nothing that you could put that was capable of registering like a 100,000 volt charge into that circuit and read that 110,000 volts or whatever it is, or 90,000 volts, because the actual device that would be required to read that voltage would exceed the current that voltage was running at, and you'd never actually see it on the scope. It might be possible with digital voltmeters, but again, I'd like to see you get a 100,000 volt capable digital voltmeter.
Yeah,
it'd be a beast of a tool, isn't it? You know what I'm saying?
Shall we have another quick tune?
Yeah, go on then.
Well,
Let the poor people. Well, hold on, let me just quickly finish here on the electrobiology. So essentially, what we're seeing when we're seeing plant morphology is really we're seeing a combination of the standing corona discharge of that particular piece of soil. So there'll be some little electromagnetic particle or some quartz crystal in there or whatever that happens to be focusing the local electrical field due to its particular electrical properties, and basically focusing a little standing wave of upside-down lightning that's standing in the soil that we can't see. Now, the seed comes along and it sits on that point, which is why some seeds germinate and others don't, because they don't happen to land on a bloody spike or near enough to one to move it towards them. And this is the other thing as well, is a seed may well draw its own, corona discharge to itself by its own electrical properties and changing the electrical properties of the soil around it. So, again, because this is invisible, it's almost impossible to actually predict exactly what's happening, but I think it's a good enough model that from the consideration of this corona discharge, of this sort of plasma ball-type behaviour of the soil, that if that sort of fluctuating lightning that we see fluxing in the plasma ball is actually like a fixed standing wave that's determined by the soil conditions locally, and pretty much stays put because there's a thing in the soil that stays where it is. So the electrical properties of that little specific place tend to largely remain the same. So essentially we've got this fixed upside down lightning coming out of the ground, which has a really a distinct electrical shape and sets of electrical properties. And again, the shapes, the reason why it takes that lightning shape and will stand there like that is because all the tips will be carrying exactly the same charge, and will be charge distributed, and will be like charges, and will repel to a 30 degree, or approximate 30 degree, and with a Fibonacci and phi branching.
So,
essentially, what we see as a plant is what happens when atoms follow that path of least resistance up that standing wave in the coronal discharge. And that the shape of plants is some sort of correlation between the existing standing charge and the local field effects of, say, the tips of the growing leaves, the tips of the growing stems, which is why we see leaves. And I think the reason that the leaves take the shapes that they do is not because of some decision on the plant to make a pretty leaf. It's because that's the shape that the charge is leaving the tips of their branches at.
It would be very interesting, wouldn't it,
we've got all the Carillion photography and stuff like that, and I think that it's all we're seeing with Carillion photography is simply the nearest thing that we can get to seeing this corona discharge by placing the biological item on a highly charged plate.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
Effectively we're turning the existing cold, invisible corona discharge by increasing the voltage, we're turning it into a hot plasma, even if only very briefly. And that's then visible, detectable by the photographic plate, simply because it's now releasing photons. Where the cold plasma doesn't release photons, it's invisible, it's undetectable.
See, and one of the reasons why there's getting to be big gaps between what you're saying and what I'm saying is because I'm now finding myself thinking about things that I've seen as a gardener that have constantly puzzled me, like the fact that the RHS handbooks will tell you that a plant is going to have a given height and spread. And by and large, that's what happens. But every now and then, you come across a plant that should say, predictably only be doing, you know, whatever, 4 foot spread by 6 foot height or whatever, and you find one that's like 20 feet high and huge.
And how many times has the converse happened where you've taken a really healthy young tree from a nursery where it's looked like the best one of the lot and you've put it in some part of the ground and it's just refused to do a goddamn thing until you move it?
Yes,
and
exactly
the second
right.
that you move it, it's suddenly like it's restored and it busts out and there's like new shoots and it's like, why weren't you doing that over there?
Yeah, when it's basically probably still in broadly the same garden as it was before.
Mm.
Wow.
Yeah, usually it can be as little as like 6 foot.
Yeah. It is astonishing because it's just completely, it's just so completely removed from anything to do with any kind of gardening advice at all that it's amazing. It's just.
And this is the beauty of it, is that what I found is that we've had a few problems here where we actually goofed and it's actually turned out to be really bloody handy, because that mess up has allowed me to do an absolute kind of backwards analysis of what's going on. So our efforts to correct our mess up have been partially successful and have proven certain practices, but the real glory of it is that by doing a forensic analysis of what went wrong, I've been able to basically take a whole bunch of modelled electrobiology stuff and just basically apply it to what I'm expecting to see in the soil and find the soil returning exactly what I expected to find there. So it is that perfect predictive model, and I can now give any agriculturalist, any horticulturalist, any casual farmer with a voltmeter and a 20-pound, 200x field microscope, I can send them out into the field with a sheet of A4 paper of what they need to look for, what's likely to be there, what's likely to be wrong if it's not there, what you need to do about it.
So what sort of work? Can you give us an example of one of these catastrophes?
Okay, well, the actual example that I can give you directly was our example, was including far too much partially decomposed, anaerobically composted wood chippings into our soil medium. A complete accident. Basically, we'd stored them in the same colour bags that we keep our compost cooking in when it's done.
Yeah, yeah.
And it got mixed in with the soil before we'd even realised what was happening, and you couldn't get it back out once it was in.
Mm.
So basically we had all this horrible, like, chainsaw-infested, oil-soaked, nasty lignite and cellulose. It's all hardwood sawdust as well. It was all, like, seasoned hardwood sawdust, so
quite
baking rock hard as well, and
yeah.
Completely indigestible to man, beast, or microbial life. The only thing that can eat the damn stuff is fungi, is hyphal roots.
Mm.
And, essentially we realised kind of what we'd done wrong, and we did our very best to kind of mulch it and add bugs and live stuff all over the place. So we basically tried to include as much biology as would be absent because of the conditions. We added loads of, like I say, we started brewing compost soups and stuff to increase the protozoal load and the numbers of amoebas and stuff in there. But even with all of this, the top sort of 6 inches or so never really recovered. And essentially, as I've gone down through the sort of soil column with the microscope, the one donated with P.I.R. listeners' money, thank you very much. Fabulous thing it is, 1,000 times for 70 quid. You know, I mean, 1,000 times lab microscope for 70 quid is just...
Stunning pictures you're getting
incredible.
From it.
Well, and yeah, that's a 1 millimetre frame. The entire screen is filled with a millimetre. So this is just an incredible level of detail that I can work to. And essentially, going through the soil medium, the upper layers... There was no biology in there at all. There was no soil creation. There was just particles. There was loose particles that couldn't be described as soil. And you could actually see sort of partially decomposed sort of cellulite and lignite bundles that were just breaking down into dust. And literally the only living organism within that top 6 inches was mycorrhizomal hyphae. and there were thousands of them. There was barely a sawdust chip that wasn't attached to another sawdust chip by a hyphae. So they were doing fine. But the trouble is, soil isn't just hyphae. Hyphae, I think they turn the soil alkaline, but don't quote me on that. They have a specific effect over the soil, and it's not particularly harmonic. They need the microbial life to balance them. So if you've got soil that only has rhizomal fungi, it will probably have an overly high pH. And the way to correct that, apart from adding compost, which is really the primary thing, you've got to add life. That it's no good just adding the protozoa and the amoeba if there's not the mites and the nematodes and stuff to feed on them, because that's where the food comes from. So you can add the battery and you can add the wiring, but unless you put in the farmers, that's all going to die back.
Nice metaphor.
You like that, didn't you?
Yeah.
And moreover, all these critters as well stratify within the soil medium. And so by the time I'd got down to sort of the last 2 inches, we had this like biological map of all glory going on.
So they'd all
run 2 inches in a probably 12 inch soil depth. The plants are actually being kept alive by all the biology in the bottom 2 inches.
So the biology had basically run as far as it could run and was working quite normal.
Essentially, the soil in the bottom had been an older batch of soil that wasn't contaminated with the sawdust as well. So that was an advantage. And it had the dodgy soil put on top. So
yes, I don't think wood chip's good stuff to have in your soil necessarily.
Oh, it's fine for mulch. It's great on the top because it'll keep the weeds away.
Yeah,
absolutely. But it's no good in your soil as an actual medium until it's been acted on aerobically. And the only way of doing that is to incorporate it into your compost heap in small enough quantities that it never actually clumps together. And the same goes for your grass clippings as well. You don't really want your grass clippings turning into those big yellow wads that everybody seems to have in their compost heap that drive me insane, because that's an anaerobic clump. What we need is aerobic critters. That's the anaerobic ones are the ones that make us sick.
That's largely because the grass, if you want it to compost, it's got to be layered with other things. It's really good for generating heat, but it won't.
It's also really important. It's really important as well to try and get a balance in your compost of what's called green compost and brown compost. So you want as many sticks as you've got leaves, basically. Yeah. And the other, and if you don't have a particularly active compost heap, you can literally go out and collect biology. One of the great things this time of year is all them soggy leaves that are kind of hovering around in every ditch and dike and curb. Go and hoof some of them up, because trust me, they are going to be alive with critters by now.
Yeah, wouldn't recommend putting them in your compost heap. It's a bit of a separate process dealing with leaves from dealing with compost, I think.
I would include them into the compost. I'd just simply mix them in.
Yeah,
because essentially what you're doing there is, with every one of those leaves that you're picking up, you might be picking up maybe 150 compost worms, maybe 10,000 mites, a few dozen nematodes, a few tens of thousands of nematodes, and God knows how many protozoa and amoeba. And along with that, all of the mycorrhizomal spores, which will be already in existence in the dust that the leaves have fallen into.
Mm-hmm.
So you're actually incorporating with those dead leaves that are lying in the curb right now. You've got just about everything that you need for next year. You just need to get it in the right place. You put it on the top of your soil is fine. I mean, all of these things where, you don't put dead leaves on the top of your soil. Man, we take our dead leaves and specifically put them on the top of our soil.
Well, that's daft, because that's where they actually fall anyway.
Exactly.
And they work pretty well there. The thing is,
if you've got live worms in your soil, you don't need to worry about leaves on the top, because trust me, the worms just come up and get them.
Absolutely right. Absolutely right. In fact, the worms will try and pull practically anything into the soil.
What I've been really surprised about is my wormery suddenly acquired a whole crop of tiger compost worms. I have no idea where they've come from. I certainly didn't put them in there.
Oh, well, they'll be useful to you, though, won't they? They breed.
Oh,
quite,
yeah, there's many species. Again, there, this is the wormery is another effort in maximising biology. So every effort, even if I'm sweeping dust from my concrete patio, I'll put that dust into the wormery or into the compost bin. And the reason why I do that is because that dust is laden with biology.
And that's, from your point of view, that's the main job of the wormery, is to produce the biology.
Basically, the stuff that comes out the back of a worm is 1,000 times more biologically active than the stuff that goes in the front of it.
So these critters are coming... So critters come out of worms?
The microbial stuff, yeah. The real microscopic stuff, yeah. There's 1,000 times more of it in a worm casting than there was in the stuff that went in at the front end.
I'd really love to have a wormery. I know a couple of people who've got them, and they're fascinating things. They're the only kind of pets I want, really.
Yeah, you've got a bit of an itinerant lifestyle to have a wormery, really. They take a bit of time and care, really.
That's a main challenge on a lot of
things. I've crashed my colony here so many times, it's embarrassing. Mm. To go out there and find a whole bunch of dead worms floating around in a bunch of water is really quite sad.
Yeah,
I don't do that anymore. My colony now is like living like the Ritz. I've got like the Park Lane and Mayfair of wormeries going on, and my worms are like the happiest goddamn things on the planet.
So what sort
like
of
my
thing,
bloody dog.
What sort
like
of thing,
waggy.
What sort of things did you do to them to wreck them?
Largely neglect, misfeeding, so too much household waste and not enough garden waste. Again, a mismatch between the brown and the green, so overly green, not enough brown. Not enough grit, too much water. There's lots of little adjustments. They'll quite happily live in your average compost heap, but when it comes to the isolated environment of the wormery, it's so under human control that their life or death is really on your shoulders. Mm-hmm. So best you learn what you're doing and do it quick. It's fairly easy. It's not hard. It's not difficult, but it can be quite complicated at times and quite, you know what I mean?
Well, small mistakes can make a huge difference in gardening. With the business, especially with
a huge colony of creatures, you know what I mean? My wormery, I think I've now probably got 20 kilos of worms or more. So, you know what I mean? Every time I change a drawer, I'm dealing with the lives of, you know what I mean, 5,000, 7,000, 10,000 individuals.
Mm.
And I've got to now successfully transfer them from the done drawer down to the not done drawer without killing them or hurting them in the process.
Yeah. With the with this business of seeds sometimes germinating and sometimes not, are there things we could do in places where we're going to be sowing, say, our peas and beans, which would increase the chance of them actually germinating?
And increase the biology.
Just increase the biology.
It's almost like a Zen-like answer that you can give to almost any question as to what can I do to make this better in biology. Increase the amount of biology, increase the biological diversity, ignore the rule book.
And would you reckon that you'd be better off? Because, I mean, I do my leaves in leaf mould piles, and they make for a really nice, water-retentive, flaky kind of medium, and I mix
right,
them.
Leaf trenches are a really good way. If you've got a particular part of your garden that's working particularly well, then you can assume that you've done pretty well in maximising the biological diversity in that area. Now, the problem is that your soil medium is quite a barrier in a modern garden because of all the footpaths and things in the way and the sort of compacted ground that these things can't travel through. So essentially, you've got to provide motorways for them, and leaves are the best thing for that. And basically, you just slap a spade in the ground, wiggle it, stuff it full of leaves and create pathways from your good soil to the bits that you're about to start using.
Wildlife.
And like I say, within a matter of days, the hyphae will be down there. Within a matter of weeks, all of the protozoa and that will have followed. And within a few weeks after that, all of your nano, you know what I mean, your ticks and your mites and your nematodes will have all migrated with them.
And this, of course, is a reason for why we should be trying to avoid walking on the surface of places where we want to actually be growing things.
Again, if there's enough biology in it, it's not too much of a problem. That only becomes a problem when you're walking on bare soil that hasn't got anything living in it. If you take a piece of soil and it's decently biologically active, the damn stuff should be moving in your hand. There's no way you can compact that.
Mm.
Not with a human weight on it, not for any more than like a day. It'll just spring back.
Yeah.
There's too much wriggling going on.
I've
pulled up a few fields, like image fields on the microscope so far, and I'm like sitting here thinking, well, there's not much going on there. And then you wait for a while, and then you wait for a while, and it's like your eyes start to get in, like come in to the image that you're seeing. and you slowly start to see that everything is moving. It's not just that there's nothing moving, it's like everything's moving. Everything's jiggling and slightly wriggling and kind of wavering, and there's little things wriggling in and out that you didn't notice at first. And I mean, I'm seeing nematodes that are a tenth of a millimetre long, and they're nice and easy to see. But they're little cousins, and the little baby nematodes, they're like kind of, you know what I mean, not even a hair at this sort of scale. You know what I mean? These are microscopic, so even at 1,000 times, you can barely make them out. Some of the protozoa are so transparent that you don't even see them until a tick comes along and tries to eat them.
Yeah, I must admit, you've...
It's a different world. It's a different world. Everybody should get a microscope. I mean, it's a fascination. I've probably spent 1,000 hours under this bloody microscope since the day or two before Christmas Eve.
It's when it arrived. You've really... I must admit, you've really enthused me about all of this. As you know, I love the gardening. It's one of the things that I do. But here's a whole new dimension to something I've been doing for 25 years.
And moreover, you now no longer have to ask yourself any questions about it. You just have the answers. And this is the really remarkable thing about the electrobiology stuff, is that if you really get the principles of how a plant works, you can apply that to every plant. You can look at every plant, see what it's doing, know why it's doing it, know how it's doing it, know what it needs to do it better, know what to do if it's not doing it very well.
Yeah. And it does explain why. I mean, over the years, we used to do kind of larger landscaping jobs where we'd be planting, say, £5,000 worth of plants at commercial prices. And we used to allow for a 10 or 15% mortality rate on our planting, i.e. we expected 15% of the plants we planted to die.
Nick.
It's no longer the case.
Nick.
Yeah.
Have you seen the time?
I have, yeah. We're 6 minutes away from the end, mate. We got.
I was looking at. Is that 9:54? Oh, no. Jesus! No, put my glasses on. It's nearly midnight.
It's one of the things that
we didn't even get to cosmology, did we?
We didn't bloody get to cosmology.
We got to the frame of reference. So at least you should, basically, from that frame of reference, if you understand, the only reason why we see straight lines in geometry is because we're coming from the same frame of reference that geometry is moving at. So we're moving at the same speed in the same direction as that geometry, but that geometry doesn't actually exist in reality. It's actually a description of a spiral, and that explains all the other cosmology.
Everything is spinning. Everything is spinning. And if you make...
Which is why everything, when we look up in the sky, everything is spirals.
Yep. And when you... I mean, I was recently watching some, I think it probably was Thunderbolt stuff, and I was watching a thing about how galaxies are actually communicating with each other with these kind of twisting plasma electrical loops right the way across.
And if it's in glow mode, it is actually conductive to electricity, and so data can quite literally be transmitted from one to the other, whether that be vibrational or radio frequency or whatever. And it's suggested now that the electromagnetic field of the Earth would have enough data carrying capacity to effectively explain the Akashic record of myth and mythology.
So wow, that's great. So that might actually be that, or indeed the morphogenetic field.
Well, I would suggest this is actually what I've described tonight is the morphogenetic field. And morphogenesis is the description of the shapes of biology. That's the actual study of morphogenesis. It's not a Sheldrakean made-up name. Morphology is the study of plant shapes or animal shapes.
Yeah.
And I've just given you why animals are the shape that they are.
Mm. And why plants are the shape they are, and why galaxies are the shape they are, why the geometry is what it is.
And it'll be the same reason why birds fly in the patterns that they do, and butterflies are the shapes that they are, and insects are the shapes they are, and...
So Joni Mitchell was completely right when she said it's all the same fucking thing, man.
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, we got less than 3 minutes left, Jack. as usual, the encounter with you has been something of a time warp. The time has completely shot by. I've barely made it a third of a way through my first bottle of Hobgoblin. And like I say, I've been scribbling notes, not questions to ask you, but things I want to go and try in the garden. It's not that I've not been paying attention. It's just that you don't want to forget it, you know.
No, I think we've done a. I think we've done a fine job. I was. There were certain elements that I was really quite concerned with the show with Vin, that because of the time constraints and because of the sort of enthusiasm and the nerves that I'd messed up a bit. And I'm really happy that we've, even if we haven't revisited most of the ground from that show, I was actually not wanting to do that. So we've given the outline of the information from that show, and we've taken it to an entirely different level. And done exactly what was needed to do, which is to take the various components and dismantle those so that they become explicable and understandable and not mysterious.
Yeah, that's great. Well, you can expect a few Skype questions from me as I listen to the podcast, but there will be a pod there will be a pod of this. There is a pod of your chat with Vin, and there's also a podcast of your chat with Sean. And you say there's one for the chat with Lee as well. And
anything that I've done isn't up on my personal Freeman Jack channel, then go to my Open Omniversity and you'll find it there. That's Open, O-P-E-N, and Omniversity, O-M-N-I-V-E-R-S-I-T-I.
Do go and give it a look, folks. It's so full of fascinating things to watch. It really is. And as usual, it's a real education. And this time, this genuinely is groundbreaking material.
Well, if this holds water, this could be as important as Darwinism. And moreover, I think that this possibly explains the fundamental disconnect between the sort of Christian fundamentalists and the evolutionists, is because they're both right. Evolution is linear, but no, there isn't any missing links.
No. No,
because of these separation layers of ball capacitance. Because when a species evolves, it doesn't do it in a linear fashion. It does it in jumps.
Yeah. Okay. Well, we've got we've now 15 seconds, as far as I can tell, from what they tell us is going to be 2016. So I'm
going
to be.
I can hear the fireworks going off now. Yeah. Happy New Year, people.
Happy New Year, Jack. Happy New Year to everybody in the chat box. Tony Hurst is coming up next with tunes
Looking
from the chat room. There it is. There's the New Year's thingy. So I'm going to play this thing that Nick sent me, Die Toten Hosen and Auld Lang Syne. And I'll be back with you next week. Thanks, Jack. Thanks, folks. This was Dr. Rock's radio show with Freeman Jack on peoplesinternetradio.com. Thanks to everybody who's been involved in keeping us on the road for the last year. It's not easy, but we're still here, and some mad bastard's still letting us be here, which is great. So goodbye from me. Goodbye from me. Goodbye from him. Here's a bit of foreign music.